called The Forum of the Future of Hawaii, about sovereignty. What path is sovereignty? What kind of sovereignty is, at least, is what I am expecting. I'm sitting on this side. This table is going to be, we'll show you the names here. Zuria Key, Davis Price, Robin Danner, Michelle Kauhani. I don't know how to characterize them, but it's going to be on one side. And on the other side, Kukahakalau, Kalama Niheo, Mililani Trask, and Kaukaohu Kanuma. I'm sorry. Kahokahi Kanuma. The Big Island, I think.
Hello, Matsuoka, all of the live stream. Who else is live streaming this evening? Raise your hand. Hello. Hi, Tita. So we're going to start off, so if you feel free to live stream.
So we'll be starting soon. It's well covered. POVs the better.
Thank you.
unfaithfully for me I from Hoki Maya. Eke Akua,
Eke Akua,
Mahalo no,
Mahalo no,
Mahalo ya oi,
Mahalo ya oi,
Noke ya ai,
Noke ya ai,
Amene,
Amene,
Amene, Amene. Thank you, folks, are welcome to go on and get your dinner, because this is dinner time. So mahalo nui to everybody that the papa kole ohana that made beef stew. So we got beef stew, rice, salad, and some from Maho Farms, and some peaches. We got water and juice, so.
Lots of people eat. The program's gonna start in about 10 minutes, so this is the perfect time for you guys to eat. And we will share it. Mahalo.
Okay, if you joined us, we're at the Aloha Āina Forum for the future of Hawaii, or the future of the Hawaiian Nation, actually. The program will begin, the actual forum itself will begin in about 10 minutes or so. So stand by. There are a lot of people here. And there's food here. So people are gonna get some food together. The young and old people. There's a very diverse.
There's lots of food, beef stew that Ohana from Papakolea made, as well as Kalani from Ohana from
I'm gonna post this.
Yeah, and I'm live streaming. Kingdom Media, Scotty Wong is also live streaming.
Okay.
And there are actually a couple others.
I should check them. Okay. So it'll be online then.
Yeah,
because I can't stay a whole night.
It'll definitely be online. Then I'll put it up on my YouTube.
Come enjoy it. And in 15 minutes.
Oh, YouTube.
Yeah. Get ready. It's gonna, get ready.
What should I look for? I don't need it till like Monday.
Okay.
Yeah. What should I look for on YouTube? What's search for?
Well, it's H. Doug Matsuoka.
Okay.
Be there. Okay. Live stream to H. Doug Matsuoka.
Got it. Okay. Thanks, Doug.
Okay. Okay, good. Civil Beat is here, so it looks like it's worth covering. We got one of the first streamers from Occupy Wall Street. He is visiting Hawaii, and he is here. It is a significant gathering. I think first time maybe these people with such diverse opinions will be together. So we'll get to hear them. They're starting it as a very peaceful, happy kind of way with food, and they're going to share some ava with the panelists also before they begin. Some of the arguments have gotten a little adversarial in the past, so it's good to see at least things starting out all right. That's Kalama Niheu, center screen. Ikaika Hussey, Hawaii Independent. In the foreground to the left is Oren. Video guy, and in the pink shirt is Joshua Nonga.
Live streaming right now.
Yeah, live streaming right now. You want to say something? Kauka ohu wahila.
Aloha ai hai, lahu ya vai, kapu kalani wahilani. We're here for a forum on presentation. It's a presentation this evening on both sides of the coin. Independence and federal recognition for Lahu Hawaii. So we have some very good speakers there. As you can see, we have a lot of people here. Mahalo nui loa for everybody coming out. Mahalo nui loa to you. And if you still got time, ele mai mahane, come down.
Come down.
It's going to be a very informative presentation, and you can have questions, your questions asked on the panelists. So on the independent side, we have three representing Mokokia. We have Ku Kakalao, who's an educator, Kanaka, Olelo Hawaii, as well as Kohokai Kanua, who's also an educator, Olelo Hawaii. And then we have Ati Mililani Chas, need I say more. And then we round it off for Oahu, our fourth representative for independence, Dr. Kalamaoka'aina Niheu. And then on the federal recognition side, we have President for the Shaw, that would be Michelle Kawahane. And then for CNH, and then for CNHA would be Robin Danner, she's here as well. And then we have Davis Price, who's an attorney and he works at OHA. He was also a participant in Nayapuni is here, and I believe the fourth is Ziaki. So, you know, come down if you're not doing it.
Come down. We're at Farrington High School Cafeteria, right in the middle of town.
Yes, okay. So, Mahalo,
thank you. And in the background, who was playing was Hawaii Loa. All Hawaii Stands Together by written by Liko Martin. There we go. Sing along. People can sing along. We're waiting for the program to start. It's Hawaiian style. So there's, you know, food here. We're at the Farrington High School Cafeteria in the middle of Honolulu. So if you can come down, you should come down. This is... you're not going to get these people together. These people don't come together too often. By these people, I mean the panel with very sometimes opposing views on how Hawaiian nationhood, sovereignty, independence should, what path to go down. So come down, you can ask questions. So far, the vibe is very friendly, very good.
Hey, how are you doing?
Long time no see.
Yeah.
I am live streaming.
Oh, awesome.
This is gonna be good.
Wow, there's a lot of beautiful energy here.
Yeah, no. So far, the energy is really good because
it's like one wave, like an awesome wave that's just starting to form here, rising on the horizon. And it's like, oh, I can feel it. The excitement is
good. It's so good, man.
It's gonna be very interesting.
I'm hoping everybody shows up because we don't see these guys with those guys in the same room very well.
Yes, I'm so happy you're getting it all documented.
Yeah. Telling people to hang with us. It'll start as soon as people get some food and sit down Hawaiian style. If you're in Honolulu, we're in the Farrington High School Cafeteria.
Yes.
A lot of parking, come down, middle of town. Everybody's welcome.
Beautiful pohaku outside the door, welcoming us in.
All right. Good seeing you, man. You're doing the teaching gig, huh?
Yeah.
All right.
Traveling teacher. I'm a traveling teacher.
Where have you been teaching?
Waianae mainly. I had a long-term gig. Waianae.
You wanna say something on screen? Haole boy.
Something.
Good to see you here, man.
Yes, and it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Doug.
Thanks.
By the way, Doug opened for Gregory Isaacs.
I did.
Known fact.
I did.
He's very humble about it. I just want to make that known. Doug, I'm not worthy.
Well, I was one of the people in the band.
Aloha Āina. Little love. Kalamai. I received a question about how people can let others know to watch live stream. This event is being live streamed through several people. People wanted to know how to find that. So you would hashtag on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter. You would hashtag AAA Forum 2016, and you would push latest. And you would be able to see the most recent questions that have been submitted, as well as the people that are live streaming. Also, if you're here tonight at the event, please come see us at the front table. If you did not get one already, come get a card, an index card, and write down any question that you have. Mahalo.
Hashtag AAA Forum.
Once again, hashtag AAA Forum 2016.
The AAA
hashtag
is
AAA Forum 2016.
Aloha Āina. Aha Aloha Āina. AAA Forum 2016. Thank you. We're starting up soon. Started off with Kioni, some ceremony and then some food. Live streamers don't eat. It's okay to offer live streamers water, because you can drink that without putting anything down. Ooh, look at that. People, you gotta come down and get beef stew. Check that out. Beef stew, right?
I'm making a tweet right now.
Huh?
I'm making a tweet right now. I'm making a tweet right now, just sending the word out.
Good. Are you gonna be live streaming?
I will be live streaming on my Facebook channel, yes.
Okay, tell people, you're live now, tell people who you are and how to get to your live stream.
My name is Michael
Pelo. Hello, everyone.
Also known as Pelo Libertas.
Welcome to the Aloha Āina Forum.
My Facebook handle is Occupy Tour Guide.
I wanted to just find me.
All right. And you're going to be live streaming from Facebook.
Yeah.
Okay, live streaming.
Write questions now. But right now, we want to start the forum in the interest of time, and we want to honor the time of our speakers. So we're going to stop the food line. What we're going to do is we're going to serve you. And that's the real traditional way of. Doing things anyway. So you guys sit down. We will bring the kamea'ai to you. Okay? So we're gonna ask our speakers to come onto the table and we're gonna start our forum. That's what we're all here for.
I'm looking at the bar table there, taking their seat on the left. Mililani Tras, Kalama Nihiu. Mililani and her sister Haunani Kate Trask. I remember at the first revived La Ho'i Ho'i in 1987, I believe it was, with a serious aim of restoring Hawaiian independence. If you're new to this, people think Hawaii is a state that was a territory that was annexed in 1897. The problem is there's no treaty of annexation. It was done by a joint resolution of Congress. You can't run around annexing countries with a joint resolution of Congress. Anyway, there are many who want to reassert the independence of the Hawaiian nation, and this has suddenly gained some prominence.
Oh my kapo!
I'll talk to you later.
How's the food? Let me give a round of applause for all the people that prepared the meai. Hello, my kapo. My name is Joshua Yohane Noma. I'm from the Ahuwa Kali Palama. I'm a Farrington graduate, so welcome to my house. I want to aha, Aloha Āina organizer. I, along with many people, helped to put this 100% grassroots community event, informational event, on for you tonight. Yeah. And for the people in the live feed.
Yeah.
I want to tell you a little bit about what Aha Aloha Āina is, who we are, and then we will get into our program. Hiki no?
Hey.
Aha Aloha Āina is a coalition of individuals, businesses, organizations that are committed to the reaffirming our independence and the restoration of the Hawaiian Kingdom. We work collectively on a model of self-governance that is completely independent out of the control of the state of Hawaii. We have conducted over 30 community meetings on the islands of Oahu, Maui, Hawaii Island, Lana'i, Molokai, as well as in Mokuhonu, in cities like Salt Lake City, San Diego, Los Angeles, Seattle, Washington, D.C., as well as New York City. Over the past year, over 3,000 people have participated in Aha Aloha Āina, in our model, our Kino model of self-governance, and reaffirming our themes. Okay? Now, we believe, both working with Kanaka and non-Kanaka, we provide a true model of self-determination that is independent out of the, that is independent from the control of the settler state. While we've worked toward our ultimate goal of independence from the oppressor settler state, many of us are also on the front line of social justice issues, fighting for the protection of our water, to stop the desecration of our natural resources. We fight for affordable housing for all people. We fight for universal healthcare to increase our teachers' pay here in Hawaii, fighting injustices done to our houseless ohana, and many other countless fights that not only improve the quality of life for Hawaiians, but for all people of Hawaii. Those who help to organize Aloha Āina are also lawyers, teachers, cultural practitioners, medical doctors, college professors, students, trade workers, bus drivers, community organizers, social workers, farmers, fishermen and women, nurses, bus drivers, musicians, kumuhula, graphic designers, hunters, engineers, journalists, poets, artists, and these are just the people that I know personally. There are many kupokua in our efforts that I don't know, and I don't know what they do to support their families, but I mahalo their selfless contributions to our Aloha Āina. While we work toward our ultimate goal of independence from the oppressor settler state, okay, we also understand that we need to fight and engage and protect our resources that are at stake right now. We invite you, those Kanaka and non-Kanaka who would like to get involved in Aloha Āina, please go to www.ahaalohaaina.com. You can also get more information by going to our Aha Aloha Āina Facebook page or going to our Aha Aloha Āina YouTube. Mahalo.
Mahalo. Mahalo.
I mahalo each and every one of you, and I'm especially mahalo our enthused boor here tonight. That is something that I welcome. But I welcome your criticism with civility, with aloha, and with love. Sticking to the issues and leaving the personal task on the side. I will let you know that we organized this to kill three myths, okay? That Hawaiian Kingdom men are violent. We are far from violent abusers. We are nurturers, we are fathers, we are caretakers of our ohana, of our aupua'a, and of our mohi. Okay? Two, we're gonna kill this once and forever, that independence people are ignorant, are stupid, and uneducated. That is far from the truth. And tonight's forum, as well as our Aloha Āina, is gonna continue to disprove that myth. And three, most importantly, a myth that we are going to kill once and forever, that Lahui Kanaka or Hawaiian people cannot gather in a room together and have differing opinions and it be okay. I mahalo Anake who just booed me right now, and I mahalo her voice, because that is the type of voice, inclusive voice, that we encourage at the Aha Aloha Āina. That is the type of voice that is a true example of self-determination. I would like to thank you. So with that, I want to thank some people first that are making this possible. You see some of our speakers are being presented with ava. Sister T. Henderson that brought some ava, right? We have our kia'i. You see them in the red shirts, okay? If you was earlier, they blew the poo. You'll identify them in the red shirts. Our kia'i or our protectors, they are those that are gonna help us to hold the conduct of aloha so that we can continue to be successful in this meeting that we want, okay? So I'm just going to next go over a few things of how we might like to hold ourselves, okay? As a community organizer, help to facilitate groups both big and small, and one of the things that we implement is called norms and agreements. These norms and agreements are very key because in each room is different dynamics. So we are going to come up with some norms and agreements, and we have some already prepared. I really just have one. But these norms and agreements is what we're going to hold ourselves and each other accountable to, so that we can have all of our speakers present and have, most importantly, an hour of community Q&A from you guys. Okay, that's what we want. We want to get there. Okay, so really, we all know, and one of the only norms and agreements that I have is aloha kahi ike kahi, right? Love one another. Love one another. If we love one another, besides our differences of opinion, we can move forward. Now, I'd just like to open it up to the group. What is another norms and agreement that we can all hold ourselves to? Feel free to just share popcorn style. That means you just throw it out there. You can shout it out and I'll echo it out. Is there any norms and agreements that we would like to collectively hold ourselves together to make sure that we
be respectful?
Be respectful. Can we agree to being respectful by a clap of hands? There's another norms and agreement we want to hold ourselves to.
Kapu aloha.
Kapu aloha. Can we hold ourselves to kapu aloha? Is there any norms and agreements that anybody else would like to contribute to this group before we move on? Can we please put our cell phones on vibrate or turn them off? Can we all agree to that?
Yeah.
Vibrate or turn them off? I know, so busy our life. Put it on vibrate just for us. Yes, sir. Addressing your concern without hateness. Exactly. And I want to mahalo. This is my father, everybody. Apulu Iwani Moma. He's not Kanaka. He's Samoa. We bro. But he's here to learn about it. And so I welcome them. Thank you, Dad. You know, we good? All right. With that said, I would like to then go over the agenda right now before I introduce the speakers, our moderator, and our facilitator, and we'll get into our program. You can open. Okay. So each speaker is going to be given 5 minutes to present. 5 minutes to present to the general public, to our community. Okay. After the speaker's presentation, they will then immediately have one question to answer, and these questions have been prepared from our Aha Aloha Āina organizers. Because we helped to put the hana into this meeting, there are some questions that we want to have to ask directly, okay? After that immediate question, and all the presenters have spoken and presented, and they've answered their questions, our goal is to have an hour of community Q&A, okay? You can know? Just by a round of applause, can we agree to that? Mahalo. Mahalo. Thank you, Noi. I mahalo you guys for being very patient with us and our organizing crew. This is the first time we've ever done something like this, where we have opened it up to speakers. We've done Aha Aloha Āina. Now, with that said, I would like to introduce our speakers at this time. I'm just going to introduce them down the line, from this way, from left to right, from my left to this right. And then I'm going to introduce our moderators. Our moderator and then our facilitator, and then the moderator will take over and they will control the moderation, and they'll give the order of the speakers and go on and so forth. You can know? So to my far left here, we have the president of the Sovereign Council of the Hawaiian Homestead Association, or known as SHA, Mrs. Robin Danner. To her right, is the president of the Council of Native Hawaiian Advancement, Mrs. Michelle Kawahane. We invited former Governor John Waihege. He was on it. Not here. and we are. We have asked, and we have been. The invitation was accepted. From Namakalehua, which is a group of young Napio organizers, Nate Davis, and a graduate from UH Richardson School of Law, Davis Price. And the invitation was offered to Board of Trustee Peter Apo, and he's not here. And instead, we also offered for invitation to Ziriaki, who's also part of Nowemapa, and he was a chief drafter of the Naya Aupuni Constitution. To my immediate right here, we have, the Doctor of Philosophy and Indigenous Education. Sorry, very nervous here. My heroes, all the people here, right? From Dr.Ku. Yay. To her right, speaking on behalf of Aloha Āina convener, Dr. Kalamaoka'aina. To Kalama's right, good friend of mine, as well as Kia'i, you'll see him, Mauna'awa Kea, Tao Kahi Kanuma. And to our immediate right and far right, international lawyer and expert speaker in the United Nations, Mrs. Mililani Trask. There's a lot of hana that went into organizing such a diverse and well expert group of speakers. So I want to just mahalo all of our organizers out there that helped this. Big mahalo to you guys. Big mahalo to all the people on the forum. Now at this time, I would like to identify our facilitator. Our facilitator in haole terms is somebody that helps to massage the conversation along, somebody that is well respected within our community that we can all collectively in regards to. I'd like to introduce from Molokai, Uncle Walter Riddy. Hello. And finally, our moderator for this evening. He's also a good friend of mine, entrepreneur, longtime advocate for the independence movement. Also from right here in Kalihi, Ikai Kohasi.
Aloha. So my understanding is that the organizers were intending for two speakers from each side to speak and then to flip to the other side. So Ziriaki is not available today, but he was supposed to speak first. So Davis, why don't you take his 5 minutes as well as your 5 minutes?
So my name is Davis Price. I see a lot of familiar faces in this room. It was a last minute invitee to fill in. And I believe my capacity, my capacity as a participant, speaking in my capacity as a participant in the Na'i Aupuni Aha held earlier this year. So, little introduction. My ohana is from Hispua, Hupua, Kali, by way of upcountry Maui, the Kekapa'i Ha'o and Paio Ohana. And I am a graduate, not only of the law school, but of the Hawaiian Studies Kamaku Center, Kamaku Kalani Center for Hawaiian Studies at UH. And it is there that I kind of got my feet wet and kind of got tossed into the activism role alongside of many of the familiar faces I see in this room on numerous issues. It was also there that I recognized my pathway forward, which was to engage in policy I was always fascinated and always a student of our kingdom history growing up, and always raised a lot of questions about how things played out and the twists and turns that took place in that very tumultuous time. So I continued those studies. And one thing that I recognized my kuleana to be was to take on that policy role that was so critical in shaping the kingdom and our history, the future going forward from there. So what I recognized was that engagement was critical, because I saw what Haoles did within our kingdom. It played a very significant role in policy making that eroded the rights of the native people for a very long time. Very quickly. So I said, why can't we flip that on its head and do the same thing today? And then study history more, and you see the labor movement of the 50s and 60s. Check. Where you had another wave of movement and political engagement from the minorities, the workers, the disenfranchised, the underrepresented, exercising their voice and taking power. And I always questioned, where was Hawaiians' roles in all of these things? And there was Hawaiians engaged very much so at every level of this, but for some reason, the masses didn't seem to reap all the benefits. So as a student, I studied, how can we get our people in mass to protect our land? My family was displaced. Unfortunately, a bunch of my great-great-grandfather's daughters married Haoles that essentially swindled all the land from upcountry. Hence why they ended up in Kali. So how do we change these things, and how do we work with the system and utilize the tools that essentially, that's all it is to me. Government is a tool, whether it be kingdom law, state law, American law, international, it's all a tool. And the thing that I try to never forget in every step of participation that I engage in is that this is about the people and the aina. For me, I gotta look past the kingdom history. It's a small window. We have 1,000 years of history prior to that, where the focus was people and aina. And that is when our people flourished. People were surviving once the Westerners came. When the focus was people and aina, they flourished. So how do we get back to that focus? How do we get that intertwined in every piece of policy that comes out of whatever government it is we're going to participate in? So that said, I engaged in the AHA, not as a supporter of federal mission, not as a supporter of independence, but how do we get down to the facts? There's so many mistruths flying around in the air. How do we get down to the facts where people can stop looking at each other as enemies on opposite sides of the battlefield, but to engage with each other? Because unless we galvanize, it's not going to be an answer. It's going to be a very hard road forward. So I went in there thinking, I like see all these different points of view and see if we can't find one common ground. My experience was, it was not the best experience, it's not the best process, by far was broken. That's another reason why I engaged. And I respect everybody's position, you know, to not participate, to stay outside. Everybody has a role and it should be respected. And all those roles are significant and important. For me, I went inside to try and see where everybody's perspective is coming from. And like I said, to find out if there was a common ground. Because another understanding I had was that something I learned through my schooling, the people that I've spoken with, mentors, experts, was that there is no federal recognition or independence. It doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. It's two frameworks of law: self-determination, indigenous peoples, kingdom law, nationals, separate government. It doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. So why can't we move on the paths together simultaneously? And what I found in there was, no one could tell me that I was wrong, that it's one or the other. And I don't have a name drop, but significant legal experts, people that are highly respected on both sides, wouldn't give me a clear-cut answer. So, that said, my time out. Oh, give plenty of time left. Okay. So that said, again, so to find common ground, and what I found in there was a lot of hope, and that we can have very, very emotional, differing opinions and still come to a common ground and still respect each other's opinions, and that no matter what we choose, there is no clear-cut choice that says, I'm going to shut you out if I go this way, or I'm going to shut you out if I go this way. There is nothing like that. Like I said, government is a tool. Law is fluid, subject to political will determined by the people. As long as the people move together, can I stop them? Plain and simple. So all the bashing that goes on back and forth, all the kingdom guys ignorant, veteran guys sellouts, it's gotta stop. And I'm hoping, I participated with the young people in that room to try and, I guess, set an example from our generation that's kind of tired of that rhetoric, tired of the bashing. Yeah, we want to figure out a way forward. Call us idealistic, call us, but if you talk to us, I think you find out that that's not the case. So, sooner or later, I think this next generation is going to take the reins. And we're going to rock and roll, plain and simple, you know, and we're going to do it together. I stood side by side along other young people, Barakohokahi, staunch kingdom advocate. I don't oppose him. I don't think he opposes me. You know, so it's all about how we're going to forge a path together. And we're not trying to miseducate or diseducate. I think the independence discussions need to keep going. I think the work that's happening in the international arenas need to continue to happen. But that doesn't mean that because someone is working on a different platform or working within the framework of the state or the United States, that they oppose those guys. Or vice versa, it shouldn't be. And so I'll close with that. I think if there's Q&A afterwards, that might be more helpful. But mahalo for having us, and Josh, mahalo for inviting me. Appreciate it.
Question that I'd like to pose to you, Davis, and this actually might be a question that the three of you might be interested in responding to, is that, you know, we all woke up to a very different world yesterday, and given this brave new world in which we find ourselves, with a president-elect that has already said that he's going to pick, you know, an oil executive to run the Environmental Protection Agency, what are the prospects for processes such as Mai Aupuni or federal recognition in general, given this incredibly rightward change in U.S. politics?
How long do we have to answer? Can I go past the house?
I'll ask them too to respond to your response.
Check. Quick response. If there's ever been a time that we need to do exactly what I just said. Now is the time. Simple as that.
Yes.
Our natural resources, very much so, are gonna be under assault.
Yeah.
Probably more so on the mainland, on the continent than here. At first, I don't know. Who knows where they're gonna drill? But if there's ever been a time that we need to galvanize, raise our voice loud, all Hawaii stand together, is now, very much so. I don't think federal recognition, to me, is putting the cart before the horse. Federal recognition not going to solve the problem. The people going to solve the problem.
My response to that question would be that I have confidence that we are a resilient people. We have been. This is one president. We will have another president and another president. That doesn't change what we fight for to better the conditions for ourselves. So every administration comes with pluses and minuses, as this one will, so we work harder. But I also believe that there is so much work to do here at home first. We don't need to talk about recognition without first having a government. We should focus on standing up the government that must be recognized or could be recognized someday or another. But right now, there is nothing for the federal government to recognize because we have not stood up a Native Hawaiian government.
Robin, I'm gonna come back to you in a minute. Okay. So I'm gonna pass the mic now on to
taking the mic soon, Ku Kahakala. There we go.
Aloha nā kua, nā o mā kua, aloha mai nā li I Hawaii nei, aloha mai nā kupuna me nā makua me ka lehu lehu a kua mai nei. O waono o Ku Kahakala o keiki alopaka kahakala o keiki au iama, ke ahonui kahakala o I hānau ia I ke aina o ke lihi nei, a ke noho nei wau mā kukui haini ki e manawa. Aloha mai kā kō, my name is Dr.Ku Kahakalao, but I'm better known as Anti-Ku, and that's how I'm going to address you today and talk about what we believe is what we need to do as Hawaiians, which is simple, to ku a kanaka. Ku a kanaka means to stand as a Hawaiian, to live as a Hawaiian, and to be a Hawaiian. And on a day-to-day basis, it's real simple. You know, we live the values that the olelo no eau tell us to live like. We practice our own traditions that we learn from our pōmo. We use Hawaiian as the preferred mode of communication if we can. If we cannot, we talk pidgin, that's all right. We perpetuate the mindset of our kupuna as a way of life. Now, what was the mindset of my kupuna, my grandpa, born and raised in Kalihi? He and his parents, they were for independence. In fact, in 1897, 90% of everybody in Hawaii was for independence. Fast forward to 2014, I went to Keaukaha, because I'm from the Big Island, 100% of the Hawaiians there were for independence. So nothing has really changed. However, when you read this palapala that they're supposed to be using to define who we are, they said, oh, there were general comments, both supporting and opposing. Full lie, 100% of the people were against it, and here we get this supporting and opposing stuff. Moreover, this manawa continues to be misrepresented. I got this letter from Maisie, not that I'm pursuing her or anything, but I got the letter just so happened yesterday from Maisie, and it says the final rule follows extensive, passionate comments. The comments was do not create a rule. That doesn't follow making what we told them to do. And so the promises are totally hewa and incorrect. They're saying that many Native Hawaiians contend that their community's opportunities to thrive would be significantly bolstered if we became an American tribe.
Yeah.
And they claim that these formal government-to-government relationships between the Indians and the U.S. government are enormously beneficial to Native Americans. Now let's look at the Native American reality. Poverty has prevailed on preservation. Highest poverty and unemployment rates in the nation. As far as education, which is my kind of background, disproportionately underachieving, dropout rate twice the national average. So, you know, as an educator, what are the benefits of federal recognition? Well, we have two options. First of all, neither these procedures nor NAGPRA mentions one word about education. However, the top 13 countries in the world in education all make sure that in their constitution, it talks about the importance of the right of education, because that's how we establish a culture of education, where education is valued. And so, Right now, with federal recognition, you have two options. Everything stays the way it does, and education stays under the state. And we know that the Department of Education has failed our 70,000 keiki, and not just this generation, but the one before and the one before miserably. The other option, Kalamai, go back one more time, would be to create new schools like Hawaiian versions of BIA schools. And let me tell you, I'm in Indian country. You wouldn't want to attend for your kids to attend BIA schools. So, but what are the possibilities of independence? And for that now, we need to look at the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, which is an important standard that was set for the treatment of Indigenous people. Now, that was voted in 2007 by 144 states, but not the United States. So that means they're not in favor of this. And so they, again, the procedures, zero reference to this most important document for Indigenous people, even though it was signed into law by President Obama. Article 3, right to self-determination. Article 4, 8, right not to be forced to assimilate, which is happening right now. And then most importantly for me, right to set up and manage our own schools and education system. That can only happen under independence, not under being under any kind of a federal Indian kind of policy. And so we have a long history of quality education. We had the first public school system west of the Rockies, and we still believe in education. 1997, the Native Hawaiian Education Council calls for the establishment of a Hawaiian system of education. Today, we're working on a ecoversity education with Aloha. We're moving forward, and we're excited about that movement. We're working towards decolonization. The time is now to go into the next steps, which is to resist meaningfully and actively, to create, to restore our practices, and to go back to doing the things that will work for us. Mahalo.
So my question for Dr. Mahalo is, right now, Native Hawaiian youth, we represent, our youth represent a significant percentage of the Department of Education public schools, something like 25 or 26%, with Filipinos being another 25%. What do you think we should be doing now with our current Department of Education system as part of a transition to a sovereign future?
I think we've tried everything we can. Personally, I know I have. I tried to do be a good DOE teacher. I tried to have a school within a school. I tried to have a school outside, like a charter school. The reality is the Department of Education is mired in institutionalized racism, and for the first time, they are actually talking about it. So HSTA is talking institutionalized racism, and that needs to stop. You know, we cannot have 9% Japanese teachers and 27% Hawaiian students, but only 9% Japanese students and so little Hawaiian teachers, so that it's totally skewed. So I really think the only thing that will work is for us to create our own system. We're already working on it, and we just need everybody to be part of that. If we 70,000 parents stood up and said, we're not gonna send our children to a school anymore that is known to be racist, then they gotta do something. And they should give us the $600 million that they spend every year not educating Hawaiian students, and let us educate our own people.
Can I ask a little favor for folks, just to help the rest of the speakers out? Can somebody get a phone and just put your timer and put it, face it toward the speakers so that they know what the timing down is? That would be great, and that'll be easy for us so that we can actually just glance over to you and know how much time we have left. So aloha āina. I'm Dr. Kalamaoka'aina. I'm one of the people who are organizing the aloha āinas throughout the islands. Next slide. So I think that one of the things that's really, you know, surprised a lot of people was that Trump was elected. Independence people are not surprised. Lot of them are realized that what has happened in the past is happening now. It's been happening since the beginning of America has started. They have never done justice by indigenous peoples, and they have never. That right now, they got this, we have a president that is the result of underestimating the American people, and then also underestimating the level of racism that's happening in the nation itself. Next slide. And I wanted to point out that part of it is because the American system is broken. And what they've done is, I'd like to do a little bit of analogy of how they've completely been disconnected from their own people and how it's been propagated to over here. And so one of the things that they did was, in 2011, they created a Kanai Oluwalu Commission. And then what they did was, they didn't ask our community, they just assigned it to them. Because they thought they knew better. Just like, you know how the Democratic National Party thought they knew better and put Hillary in charge? Next. So what they did is, without our consent, they kind of kept on, again, you have in WikiLeaks, you have all these things going on, where Hillary is like swindling the Democratic Convention, right? Then you have here, trying to make things fit rather than actually getting true consent from the people. They rolled over these names, tens of thousands of names from the Kanai Oluwalu list over into this role. Next slide. And what they had was, in 2016, 150 unelected Ngāi Aupuni participants created a constitution without really going out into the community. Next. And one of their first acts for the interest of expediency to get this constitution written within 10 days was decided to not allow the community to present the concerns. And as a result, 8 Kanaka were arrested at the gates of this private country club simply for wanting to bring our concerns to the table. And the question is that a nation for our people? And right now, what we're looking at is a major land grab. Our analysis is, and we don't all agree with this, but what's the main reason why they want to do this? Why are they pushing it through? If you look at and study First Nations and how they have to spend all this time to get recognized the DOI, they want to quiet the title. They want to quiet the land title, 1.8 million acres of seized land. And the only land that we have guaranteed right is Koho'olawe. Are we going to live there? Can we live there as a people? Next. And the roles are, this is not anything new. Back a couple of years ago, 2014, OHA itself put out this informational poster that said, if you do not sign up for this role, you threaten the rights of you, yourself, and all your descendants forevermore to be considered a Native Hawaiian, okay? That's some really intense stuff. Okay, what we're talking about 80% of our people not on this list. Next slide. So the question then becomes, step back a minute, is federal recognition a healthy form of government? As a doctor, I can go for miles about all of the different statistics that show that it has really failed the Native American people. Next slide. But really, for those of you who have been following and paying attention, during an administration that's supposedly friendly to Native Americans compared to what Trump is supposed to be, here we have Standing Rock Sioux standing up for clean drinking water for 12 million people. And this is a response, a militarized response, where they attack unarmed Standing Rock Sioux with over-enthusiastic, like violent, militarized concussion grenades, mace, attack dogs. Next slide. And we're also looking at a president right now who completely denies that climate change is occurring. And this is not just one person. This is a representation of American policy. While this was happening, again, somebody that's supposed to be one of the guys that is pushing for climate change preparation actually signed 3 pipelines through to allow these crude oil to go through the United States. He's not stopping it, he's continuing fossil fuels. Next slide. And the thing is right now, as people don't always really consider this an option. But this is something to think about. And it's not just for us. I show here, Tokelau. There, right now, their islands are going underwater. And they're saying, we are not drowning, we are fighting. And our islands soon may rise, and we need to realize that there is a choice coming right now. And for those of you, as a scientist, as a physician, I am telling you that our people have sustainable resources, sustainable systems in place. Next slide. And what we need to do is Aloha Āina, next couple slides over. Next slide. This, look at all of our different sciences, and one of them is healthy systems of governance. And right now what we have over here, this is the Kalaimoku, our traditional form. This is what we should be basing on. This is our structure on Aloha Āina, and where everybody has a place. And that's what any pathway for. There's one thing I agree with. There's a lot of things to disagree, but if one thing that we definitely all agree on is that we need to come together, we need to unite. This is a very scary time for a lot of people, and we need to do it in a very powerful way, in a real way, in a way that's not false and manufactured, in a way that honors the work of every single person here. Mahalo.
Ask a hard question to you, which is, the federal recognition process is more or less well understood. What is the complementary process for independence?
Well, I think that there's I wish I had known I had that question. I have a really great infographic flowchart of independence that it's relatively complicated, but everybody sees it as like, oh. It's like everyone's like, what's the plan? It's like, we got a plan. And part of that plan, though, fundamentally, if you look at the United Nations, we definitely consult them about this process, and they said any government at its fundamental basis needs to start with building unity and education within the community. And that is what we're doing right now. Aloha Āina is going out without any state and federal monies. We are going out to the community and actually listening to them. You know, we don't always agree with some of the things that they're asking for. We're having a challenging time, okay? What happened when we had the halabais out there to educate people about what was happening with Na'i Aupuni? Because they weren't doing it. With all their millions of dollars, they didn't go out to our communities. So us, with zero budget, with only the aloha of our community, went out and we listened to the people. And they said, we need an aloha for our people. And we're like, gosh, we're broke. All of us up here are broke. What are we gonna do? We can't afford to have 2 weeks and, you know, even a month where we get together. So you know what? We went to every community and said, any community out there that wants to be a part of this aloha, organizing your community will go to you and we will come with you and we will listen to you. And out of that came this. Not everybody in Aloha Āina is very excited about including everybody's voices here, but we are here because we need to start talking. There's one thing that we need to do is we need to start talking to each other. And there's a lot of time pointing back and forth. All of you know, rubber bullets going back and forth. We feel like it's North Dakota again. I just came back from North Dakota. I was like, oh my God, it's like, you know. But that's the first thing that has to happen. The next thing is moving along is that we need to build international alliances. We need to go and we have to recognize first that we are an independent country and that we have leveraging that we can utilize throughout the world. That there are a lot of people throughout the world that really want to have a neutral country here rather than a military giant. And the other thing that I didn't really point out before, I've never really answered this question directly, but Rome fell from within. Empires rise and fall. Part of the plan is understanding that the United States have proven and they're showing that they are unable to care for even their own population. So it's time for the peoples throughout the world to unite in caring for the people where they are and to move away from this global domination that has been happening and has dominated and destroyed the planet. We need to move forward to a new future.
Thank you.
Don't tell Donald Trump that stuff about Rome. He's not going to like it. So for our next speaker, I just wanted to give some respect to Robin Danner, because we haven't always agreed, and I think there's a lot of folks on both sides of these tables that have not agreed for many years, and it takes a lot of courage and aloha for your people to come to this kind of event. So I want to say thank you personally for you. So Robin, you're up.
Am I answering the original question, or what did you want me to do?
Or just give your own presentation.
Oh, we have the presentation. Aloha, everybody.
Aloha.
My name is Robin Danner. I was born on the island of Kauai. Grew up in Numalu, a little fishing village where my mom and her 12 brothers and sisters grew up. I was raised fishing, and then my parents were teachers, and I spent a lot of time on the Indian reservations of the Navajo, the Hopi, the Apache, in their educational systems, and my parents were then part of the self-determination movement of the indigenous people of Alaska to free themselves from the Bureau of Indian Affairs educational system. So, Ku, you might be speaking of it, but I actually witnessed the breaking down of a BIA school and the self-determination of a Native people, and my mother as a Native Hawaiian wanted to be a part of that, and they opened the first non-BIA high school and elementary school in rural Alaska to break the bonds of wardship, and for the last 40 years have operated their own education. So I don't think that our situation is different. I think we all have different experiences. I'm a banker by training. I want to congratulate the organizers, especially Haelani and Shane and others, for this gathering. I mean, when I saw the materials presented and just the logistics of everything, I want to congratulate you on a job well done for tonight. It actually reminded me of about 20 years ago when we were all part of, and still part of, Kalahui. And when Kalahui raised money from the federal government through the ANA program and funded hundreds of workshops under the leadership of Mililani, when we worked together, and then when I met Haelani and Shane was about almost 20 years ago, they came on board with Kalahui, and we worked on Project Hawaiian Justice, which was a Kalahui initiative to understand and put forward one of the three rings of sovereignty that we learned so well through the Kalahui work from the 1980s. I didn't get started till 1993, which was about federal acknowledgement, federal recognition. What I want to respond to is that we have got to stop mischaracterizations. We need to be in control of our own education. We need to be in control of our own businesses. We need to grow Native-controlled businesses, our educational schools. The charter school movement and the indigenous education has been wildly successful. But the Native Hawaiian Education Council, for example, that Ku spoke about, was not formed by the Kingdom of Hawaii, was not formed by the state of Hawaii. It was legislated by the federal government, the Native Hawaiian Education Act. So my message with that is that we cannot be all for and all against. We as Hawaiians, given our history, given where our children are, given where our spouses are, given where incarceration is, we must take every tool. We must not deny ourselves, our elders, or the next generation of millennials any tool, whether that is a state tool, a federal tool, or an international tool. That is the reality. And what I have come here to tell you is that very strongly, one of the mistakes we are making because it's sexy, because it's easier, is that we think it's independence or a Native government to government relationship with the United States. And we have got to stop selling that snake oil. It is not one or the other. It is both. No Hawaiian should be opposed to independence. It's in our DNA. And that is a pathway that must be traveled, traversed consistently. And it will take many generations. Because until the global power changes and the United States is no longer in charge of the UN, you can worship the UN. But that is the United States today. They are on the Security Council. They have veto power. That is the reality we live in today. So we keep the fire burning and the work that is being done on the international level, just as Indian people are doing. And we must grab hold of every tool. And federal recognition, again, is not a healthy government, young lady. Federal recognition is not a government. It is not a form of government. It is a relationship. The government is what we may choose. And so my message to our people is stop the mischaracterizations just because it's fun and it's sexy and it's cool to be Malcolm X for 5 minutes. We got to do the hard work of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Both of them, our unborn, deserve our best minds, our best debates. And I tell you, coming from someone who has been demonized in front of my grandchildren, who has been demonized when I have Kanaka boys, we have got to stop it. So I am here to say, I love my people. I am Kanaka. And I will never disrespect another Kanaka that has a better idea or even a worse idea. I celebrate all of us. And I call on my brothers and sisters that are working hard at the front lines of independence. Ayo, you must do that. And I celebrate those that must work who brought the Native Hawaiian Education Act, who brought the Native Hawaiian Housing Block Grant through the federal system. Do not deny my children or my kupuna or my neighbors from affordable housing because we have a bone to pick about the global reality of the United States. It is neither evil nor a saint. You know this. And the final thing I have to say on behalf of my family, on behalf of my nieces and nephews and my kupuna that are not only Native Hawaiian, but that are Native American, I am tired of the mischaracterization of people discussing Indian issues of which you know nothing about. Federal recognition is not the cause of the terrible poverty, the alcoholism that plagues Indian country. It is no more the cause of that than it is the cause of our own abuse of alcohol and drugs. We don't even have federal recognition. So we can't blame federal recognition. In fact, if you know your history, and I'm sorry, when you know your history, American Indians suffered over 500 years of forced assimilation, of brutal murder, not even comparable to our own experience. So have a little respect. When I hear people say, I'm not an Indian, that tells me I'm speaking to someone that doesn't know that there are no Indians, does not know that the Navajo are not Indian, they are Navajo. The Comanche are not Indian, they are Comanche. Kanaka are Kanaka. Indian is a term of art, and to flip that word around as if it's offensive is offensive to me, and I think we as Kanaka need to go back to our people, go back to the ways of our kupuna, that we do not disrespect another just because it makes us feel better or bigger. So I want to, on behalf of my nieces and nephews, some of which who have left their own aina because of some of you, 20-year-old, 18-year-old, that is not the people of my mother. And I think that I call on the kingdom. I call on the royal order here and now to implement what our elite created you for. Protocol. Proper behavior. I want our people on both sides to align with protocol. And my last closing is to make sure it's very clear. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the state of Hawaii, the county of Kauai, the county of Maui, that is recognized by the United States of America, that is recognized by New Zealand, by the European Union, and so on. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the United States. Okay? That is a Native-only government. I am for the governance my people had before the short-lived term of the kingdom. We had 2,000 years of Native-only sovereignty and governance. Number two, I am for independence of Hawaiian nationals, Native and non-Native. Those are two things. So I am for Native governance and I am for independence.
You don't speak for me.
Okay, thank you. So mahalo nui, I am for, I am not against. I am pro federal recognition and I am pro Hawaiian independence. Mahalo.
Michelle, why don't you go on with the presentation?
So, Michelle Kauhani with the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement, and first and foremost, I just want to share about what CNHA is, because I see lots of things about what we are and what we're not. And so we are a Native Hawaiian nonprofit of over 150 members locally here in the state and nationally. I see the time. CNHA is 15 years old. We have been gathering. I heard Aha Aloha Āina talk about 30 gatherings. We have been gathering in our community for 15 years. We have been holding forums, educational symposiums, summits, and hold an annual Native Hawaiian convention and have done so since our inception. We just celebrated last month our 15th annual Native Hawaiian convention. So when I hear people say, you don't speak for me, I don't. I don't speak for you, but I have a membership that I'm accountable for. You don't speak for me, and I don't speak for you. But we definitely convene our community, we speak to our members. Do all of our members support federal recognition? No. Skippy Iwane sits on my board, we have great debates. But he continues to come to my board. We work on housing. We work on Native Hawaiian education. We work on things that we can agree on. He does not agree with federal recognition, but he has not yet quit the board. He just re-upped for another term. But we are unembarrassed, we are unapologetic for being supporters of federal recognition. That did your DOI hearings have a lot of opposition? Absolutely. Because we stayed home. We stayed out of that chaos where when we stood up, we got booed. Where my husband stood outside the cafeteria at Makakilo because he was watching on television and knew I was coming up and said, holy crap, I let her go there by herself. So we submitted 5,124 comments, actually answering the questions that the DOI was asking. And so when you get frustrated about whether they heard your voice or not, you have to answer the question being posed. The question was not whether or not you supported federal recognition. The question was, if you organize yourselves as a government, Hawaiians, how shall we, the federal government, know that it is you, the government that we should be recognizing? And we didn't really answer that question verbally. We said, go home. Get out of here. A'ole, DOI. We didn't answer the question. And so, yes, we have supported federal recognition. We will continue to support federal recognition. Some people agree with Kana'i Oluwalu, some people don't. Some people have a bad taste in their mouth that the names got transferred. It's like any other vote. If you don't want to show up and cast your vote to ratify that constitution, you don't need to. But some of us want federal recognition. Not recognition that says, I am Hawaiian.
recognition that the government says, we recognize you as a government. There are lots of things that we want that are the same. But right now, the work that CNHA is focused on is really about ratification of the document. If you don't like the draft constitution, vote it down. The constitution doesn't guarantee federal recognition. The constitution lays forward before you to decide on a unicameral democracy. That is the form of government. The constitution does not say federal recognition. That is a relationship, as Robin explained. The draft constitution that will come before our people really asks you, do you support the unicameral democracy that is laid out in that document? It doesn't ask you federal recognition or independence. That is a relationship that your government may choose to have, but first we have to stand up that government. And so CNHA right now will continue to focus on education so that we, in hopes of getting to some kind of understanding, will our people vote that up or down? And if we vote it down, then we start again. But that is where we're at. I want to be clear about CNHA's position. I have 4 seconds, so I'm going to end there and take your question.
So my question is, for the individuals who have decided not to participate thus far in this process, if we were to project 20 or 30 years down the line, what do you think happens to them and to their cake?
That's not up to me. That will be up to the government once we stand that up. That is not, that's not my answer to give to you, but right now, participation is up to the individual. We chose to participate in the process. We wanted to participate. Those that didn't want to, a'ole pilikia. I support federal recognition, and I have not opposed, as Robin shared, supporters of federal recognition have been villainized as traitors, as corporate whores. But you crossed the line when you included my child. That is off limits, right? So it's,
Well, the question though was, if people, if there are Hawaiians that don't want to participate in the Na'i Aupuni, in the constitution, in the ratification, is that your question? And what about those that don't?
But let's get back to your answer after, if you want. We still have 2 more presentations, Moho'okahi and Mililani.
O ka ora iaki a pua nana mai ka mau pula pula e ora akani ko o a palalohala hau maka I ole a kau I kukua nani a mama wono. Mae ko oi mona kala I kumukahi, ai kala I kua kui kumole olu lehua. Aloha kako. Mahalo kia hui anō kako, o vau ka hoa kai kunua. Kiki papa vau no kamakukuni o Hawaii. Hano ia vau ma kia ukua o vau lua. Hana ia I leila. He keiki vau I a'o ia I pula ia maka o lalo Hawaii. Kiki papa hana vau o puna na leo. Komo wa mapapa mua loa ko puna leo kone ko makai ki ui kumei makai ko kumaha. A leila, puka mai leila, ko oma waku I ke kula kai Aupuni, o e hunui kai malino I a manawa ke kula kai Aupuni Hawaii ko kona. I ka papa e ono, a leila maape mai lele aku vau I o ahu, I kalihine I ko palama, hele kula nui ma, hele ki kula ma kamehameha. Puka vau ma kumakai ki e lua kaukani e hiku, mai ke kula kamehameha ma ka palama. Ko mau aku ke kula nui o manoa. Loa ka upalapala ma leila no ka ola no Hawaii. O vau, yeah. Ka ko ana vau I ke ia mea o ka imi ana I ke ea. Walao ia ka kia o ao ke ka hele kula ana. A me ke ea ma loko ke la. O vau hele wai kukuna na leo kona. Maka iki umi kumai wakane I kumaha. Mai e manawa aale loa ke kahi pula kai Aupuni. Mahape aku, ea mahape. Puna na leo puka pau. Hawaii oi namu haole. Hawaii oi a oi ka Star Spangled Banner a fell up. Ale ko wau makuai ai kela. Ale ko wau makuai ai kela. Puka wau meka punana leo, ko ole lako I ka hoona ni yau I ke pula Aupuni, pahumalao. A ale, noho oi make pula kamalii. Ko mau kia wana mako ole Hawaii. A pau ka mako hana aloha kau kula. E hele ai. Ano lele imi lako, imi lako, imi lako, imi noke noke, imi noke. Kulia, ahe vai pau ai. A leila, loa ka vā, e hele kula vau, make kula kai Aupuni. Vehe ia ama make kahi pula. A o ia vau mako ole Hawaii. A o ke la, ka nui o ko hele kula ana. Mai ka me ke kula kamali I ai ka papa e ono. Ale vau ole Hawaii ma ka meha mea o e ale ai ia ma ke la vā. Ko'u ko mo ana maka papa ole Hawaii. Ka kula ki e ki e, ai ia. Ola Hawaii. Kula nui, ola Hawaii. O ka uhana, he kumu vau maka kunana leo, no eiva maka iki, ola Hawaii. No leila, ka hapuni o ko uola he ola Hawaii vale no. Maloa ko ka ola Hawaii, loa ke kai ano kuana ike. Ho o paa ia, kukuru ia, ko u kuana ike mao, ko u ole. No leila, o ke ano o ko u no o no o ana, o ke ano o ka u mauhana, o ko u kuana ma mauna kea pelaku, he ho pena ke la o ke a'o ana I ko'u olelo. He ho pena ke la o ke a'o a'o ia ma ke kahi ano I kokoke I, kokoke I ke ano I ke a'o, I ke ano I a'o ia I koka puma kupuna. A ale like loa. A ale loa like. A ka maloko o ke la. Loa ka hua. Loa ka hua. A ka a ale pauma leila. No leila. No u oia ke ano. A ale ka pau noi. Ale ka ko kali ha avi mai kai pala pala. Ai e ke ea ma anei. Maloko ka ko ma anei. Ma anei. A ina ahe ea ma anei. Ale ku o ko a ma anei. Mea ole ka pala pala. Mea ole ka ole lana ki kai kanaka. Ike ma ko ya oe. Kono ka ko iki ya kapu iho. No leila. Ea. Oye ko umake make. O vau bako kau ike ya manaba. Ho iho imai. Aka. Ike le a vau, maku manawa like, a ale makau kau kapu a pau. A ale no kapu ke la heba. No ku mea, ho ame like ia, kapu kua kari a pau. Ina ale kapu ole lo vai, ho ame like ia. Maroko o kou ole lo vai iana, ho ame like nui ia pau. Aka, lo ake kahi kahua ke kahi. O ke ano ko uka hua ua like no me ke aali a ahe mea nana I kula I ahe mea nana I ka wahi ke ka hua ua ehe ua malu ua paa a imi ana e imi ana a ahe vai kawa I ka imi no leila a le kako imi ke ala ma alahi a le kako imi ke ala viki viki no kumea ua vai le mua ia ke ala ea nana I vai le mua ke ala mape mai mako na po ki I Wa ho ike ko ka po moku pune ya ka po ike ala e hele ai. Ho hele ko bamba ai, hele ka po.
So, ko wa hini nao ya hoi, no ka po e I, I'll do it in English. Do you favor an education system for Hawaii ke manawa, in which everyone would learn a lot of Hawaii?
Hey.
Ai. No ko mea.
Wait. Oh, what you say? Now tell me in English.
Ale lau ka manawa. An ale wahana e kia no ka
kōpana.
I'm not doing this to be disrespectful.
Talk to me in English.
Aka ina imi ana kapu I kia ea.
What the hell you say?
Oye ka pilikia. Oye ke kulana o kākou. Pono e ho pono pono poke ia ke la. Pono e ho pono pono poke ia ke la.
What the hell are you talking about?
Please.
No leila. Imi ana kapo ike ea. He ha avina ke ia. He ha avina ke ia. Ku ea na ke kai ikon o lelo Hawaii ana ma Hawaii ke imi ana kapo ike ea no Hawaii. E piri kia ke la. A oe ki kulana po kapo koe. Ale no kapo ka hewa. Aka pono e po ona awao ia kapo pa ko vau I kia o ano kia lame kia po e ka olelo Hawaii no ka mea o ka olelo ke ka ao ka mauli o ia ka mea ho o pa ane a ka po Eli me kau waewe o maru o paa he mihi keia a ka o ko upono keia, o ko ka po upono keia, a ale I kau.
The synopsis of what was said was that Kahoʻokahi and many others whom were schooled in our schools that were based in our language and our culture. This is a demonstration of the great divide that could potentially continue to be that divide or to turn around and be that which unites us. And so the crux of what was said is that we have a new and younger generation that has been armed and prepared with all the very basic fundamentals, the rudimentary understandings of what it means to be Kanaka from our own language perspective, and therefore, with no disrespect to any of our people who are not fluent in our mother tongue, but merely serving as an example. It is from this foundation, and it is from this, not only a place of a mind, but a heart and spirit, that our next generations base not only the understandings, but the arguments and that which our young generation will advocate for. And that is as short and sweet as I can keep it. He has said that our young people are now, we have done this, those of us, all of us in this room who have supported Hawaiian education. We have all supported our next generation to be very, very different from that which our Hawaiians who have become very, very comfortable and very assimilated within to the American way of life through no fault of our own. But this is what we are now faced with. This is actually our greatest resource, and that is our future generation.
Lenny Trask.
Aloha, everyone. Well, I want to thank those who are putting this together and also our kohanas from the Papakolea for making this mea'ai for us. Thank you so much. I wanted to start by asking for those in this room who are Hawaiian, will every Hawaiian in this room that read the 172-page DOI rule raise your hand? And those who did not, you wonder how it could have gotten this far, that it is being implemented in Washington, D.C., without the involvement of our people or the education. The good news is that yesterday, President-elect Trump put a hold on all federal positions from Sally Jewell all the way down to Mr. Stanford Enomoto, who will not be in charge of the Office of Hawaiian Nation. I never thought I would be glad to say anything about President-elect Trump, but I believe that Trump has trumped the DOI rule, and it will be DOA rather than DOI. There's no way we can go through 172 pages in 5 minutes. What I wanted to say was just a few points, 4 points. Number one, why are we talking about a federal rule for federal recognition? What is the purpose of this thing? It didn't come from Hawaii, it came down a few years ago. Well, if you didn't read the 172 pages, you might miss what's on page 59,114. If you read page 59,114, it tells you why we're doing this. We're doing this because some Hawaiians want to exercise inherent sovereign powers so that they can, quote, facilitate the implementation of programs and services that Congress creates specifically to benefit Native Hawaiians. The purpose of the rule is not to give to our people self-determination, but to facilitate the ability of a few to gain sole control of the congressional funding and programs. Read what is in the paper, because what you're being told is not the truth. Point number two, this process...
We can't hear.
Point number two, this process does not give our people the right of self-determination under international law. The right of self-determination is the right of all peoples, with an S. It's a collective right of Hawaiians to determine our political status. What shall be the nation that we shall create, that we shall be citizens of? And by virtue of that right to freely pursue our cultural, economic, and social development, our ability to develop our own economic system, to lay taxes, to raise revenues, to tax others who work on our land, to build housing, to build clinics, to put up schools. This is the definition of social development. What is the purpose of this? Purpose is to facilitate receiving government programs from the Congress, not to allow us to form a nation. Point number three, this is not federal recognition under the current federal policy. If you go back and look up President Ronald Reagan, federal recognition of self-determination, you'll find the statement that President Reagan, a Republican, put on the record. Reagan came out and said, it's time for America to stop treating Indians like wards. It's time to give them their trust lands and empower them so that they can manage their own affairs, return to them their lands, territories, and resources. This is an excuse being called federal recognition, but if you read the 172 pages, you'll see that it says that the Hawaiian Nation will never have any trust lands. All trust lands held by the state remain with the state. All those held by the federal government remain with the federal government. The only exception for the Hawaiian Nation is Kaho'olawe, the bombing target, littered with live bombs, no homes, no clinics, no schools for our children. That is what it says. But you didn't have the chance to read it, and no one pushing it is going to explain it to you. The Indian nations have powers the Hawaiian nations will never have. If you read the jurisdictional statutes of the United States, it says that when American Indians and their governments wish to challenge the United States, they go to the federal district court, and the United States must respond. Well, if you read what they're saying for our nation, you can try to sue the federal government, but the federal government has sovereign immunity, so they don't have to answer. That is not federal recognition that the American Indians have, not that we are Indians. One of the things that greatly concerns me is that this process requires that we relinquish our claims from the overthrow of our independent kingdom, that we relinquish it. We will never be able to retain that what was taken. And I'm very concerned with the deliberate program of misinformation coming from people like Zuriaki saying that there is no human right to restitution. This is a lie. A lie. Leave me alone. The love of Juan Pisica. United Nations expert and special rapporteur on the human right of restitution wrote a report telling us what our right was. And 3 years later, the United Nations Committee to Eliminate Racial Discrimination, a binding treaty on the United States, issued this statement. The committee urges all states, including America, to recognize and protect the rights of indigenous peoples to own, develop, control, and use their communal lands, territories, and resources, where they are deprived of their lands, territories traditionally owned or otherwise inhabited, to return to them their lands and territories. And only when this is not possible for factual reasons should the right of restitution be substituted with the right of compensation. And upon that occurring, compensation shall be paid in the form of land and territories. We have a right to be restored. Our country, our nation, our right to be self-governed. These are our human rights. America didn't like it. This we passed in 1997. The declaration passed in 2007, America refused to sign. 2008, America came to the CERT committee and said we will not obey the declaration. It's not a binding treaty, and America didn't sign it. America doesn't recognize Hawaiians, only Indians. And the CERT committee said back to America, we note your comment. We decide, however, to use this law to interpret your American binding human rights treaties. So you see, America was struck down in 2008. This we must oppose, election or not. We're gonna oppose this. But I believe that President-elect Donald Trump will do this for us. And already I have sent to President-elect Donald Trump a request to ensure that we do not have Mr. Stanford Enomoto taking over the Office of Hawaiian Relations. Nation building, I believe in it. If you want to see a real constitution written by Hawaiians, after 53 workshops, four times, 212 workshops, look at the Constitution of Kalamaoka'aina. We didn't forget education and housing like they did over there. This is a federal ruse. We need to oppose it. And thank Akua Mahalo Ke Akua that Donald Trump is here. I can tell you he will not allow this one to proceed and be the shoe.
Jumpers.
So on the CRB ZAF 540. So I believe we're going to have this microphone is available for people to line up and ask questions to the panel. But why don't we start off with Wapu'aina. Robin, I'd like you to respond to the question about Donald Trump and the right word swerve in U.S. politics.
So the question was, what impact is Donald Trump?
Is federal recognition dead?
Okay. What? Oh, is federal recognition dead? Oh. All right. Thank you. That's a great question, and it should be answered because there seems to be some misunderstanding. But the federal rules promulgated by the Department of Interior were promulgated for the federal government to be their rules, number one. Number two, it took 3 years of opening of public hearings, public comments, the record open, 3 years to do 172 pages. In September earlier this year, those rules were adopted. So, Kaika, the election of the president has no impact, no bearing on the DOI process. It's POW. In other words, what's there is a federal regulation that is written in Part 50, CFR, Code of Federal Regulations 43. There is nothing for President Obama, and there is nothing for President-elect Trump to do. It's done. It was a three-year process. It exists. It sits there in the CFR and does not have to be accessed until Native Hawaiians, until our people want to establish a native government, operate as a government, never even use the process. So I think there's some misnomer that federal recognition, the federal rules under the Department of Interior are not a land claims settlement. There better not be any mention of land or deciding what lands will be there. The federal process was merely a process for the federal government itself to have regulations that it follows, not that we follow, but that it follows in order to extend acknowledgement to a Native Hawaiian-only government. And so that process, Ikaika, was approved. The final regulation is in place. It will now sit there. It is not waiting for any federal action. It is not waiting for President Trump to do anything or for President Obama to do anything.
It's dead in the water. It's dead in the water.
Okay. Yes, question.
Still working.
Okay.
Hello. Hello, Akaku.
Aloha.
I descend from Nowemapa'aina, Eriki, Yawe, Kalamaoka'aina, Kekua Opio. This is why I take this title of Kamehameha. Nana, no disrespect to you, but you should stick to banking. You sound like an attorney over there. How many attorneys we have in this house, Hawaiian attorneys?
Okay. Wait, I need to pause. We said earlier that part of our rules of engagement for tonight is that we would be respectful to each other. So ad hominem attacks are not allowed.
Okay.
Please continue.
I've been respectful. How many attorneys? Can you please do me a favor if you're an attorney? Can you please write a letter to Mr. Trump and ask him for redress for my kingdom and our people? Redress, very important word, very, very strong word that covers it all. Money, land, everything, the kingdom come back to us. That's all you need to do. Simple, mathematics. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Aloha. This is for the federal recognition panel. In the federal recognition, if it passes, does the people of Hawaii acquiesce all of their sovereign rights to the U.S. in silent agreement? And what would that hold to our people if it happens to be acquiesced to the U.S.?
The question has never been posed before a court. My interpretation is no. And here's why. You have 125 approximately acts of Congress that have benefited Native Hawaiians. Benefit, or however you want to characterize it, served Native Hawaiians. You have homesteaders, you have 20,000 people on a homestead wait list. Act of Congress. It's not getting into driver's license, paying taxes, and all those things. But just that alone, just Hawaiian programs that Hawaiians participate in. If we were ever to admit or say that that is acquiescence, the majority of our people have acquiesced. So, in my perception, no, it's all been under the rest. And I think we have, if there's ever a court that's going to take that question, I think we have a solid argument. And no one's ever told me no. Professor William C. Chang, international law expert, I posed that same exact question for him at the OHA, at the AHA, multiple times. He told me, he never gave me a clear answer, publicly. So privately, he told me no.
It's a gray area.
He told me no. Legal experts have told me no.
So one of the clarifying things, I think it's a great question, but one of the clarifying points, once again, that we have to frame is that there are two processes. So when you say acquiesce, the question really is, I'm a homesteader, as Davis said, any scholarships that were taken under the Native Hawaiian Education Act, is that acquiescence? No. And then we have to remember the two. So the question you're asking really comes down to this. If you, does the federal recognition, a nation-to-nation relationship domestically, not internationally, impact any opportunities we have on the international arena, which is a very separate path, and which is why I can say to you, I support both. I don't need to oppose one to do the other. So to answer your question, the answer is no.
Okay, I'd like a response to from this side.
We have, like I said, two responses over there, and then we'll have two responses up here. So I'll just start off with one, and that is that when we're talking about acquiescing, we have never said plebiscite or referendum. This is recognized. Ever said that we will go under the plenary power of the United States. Plenary is absolute. Absolute. By participating in this process, and by saying that we're going to be part of this process, we're agreeing to go under the United States. We've never, our people never, ever agreed to this. We have never as a people ever done that. And internationally and also morally, ethically, we stand behind the fact that our people have never acquiesced. We have never given up. We have never yielded our lands. We have never yielded our lands. And when you take a look at we have consulted the United Nations, and they look at the process, a couple things happen. When you look at a nation, really truly internationally recognized nation, you can't have just one race. That's a violation of the human rights. There have been countries that have tried to do this before, and they're not allowed for very good reason. But you can go to look at the wrong party. And the wrong party are the people who were affected by the overthrow. And those are descendants of the Kingdom of Hawaii. And those are all the Kanaka. But there are also non-Kanaka as well. So that qualifies. That qualifies. So there is, we might disagree on the analysis of this, but we do know Native Americans. We're not the only people that, I won't pretend I'm the only person that knows, has extensive experience with Native American struggles. Because we have learned and walked together side by side because our struggles have been the same. Really, Bonnie here can share thousands of stories as well. I've been raised internationally supporting and fighting for others than side by side with indigenous people. So yes, we do understand this. Mahalo.
I think one thing we've got to do is America will proceed with you or without you. This is something that was fashioned by a few in Washington and imposed here with public hearings. Even the state legislature law said register 200,000. They spent $7 million in Poha, registered less than 20,000. And Mr. Price is saying he doesn't know any court that said that. Well, when the judicial watch took them to the district court in Honolulu, the Na'i Aupuni disincorporated themselves. Then they went ahead, threw out the roll of 20,000. They never registered with 200,000. They threw out the roll of the people and said that they're going to write their own constitution without being elected by the people. What the rule says is that America is going to recognize only one nation under their rule. This is the rule. And once that nation gets recognized, they get all the power from Congress. Congress will never recognize again another Hawaiian nation. This is in the DOI rule. So acquiesce.
Ever.
Do you have to sign up on any other various role commissions like Na'i Olu'olu to vote no against the Na'i Aupuni Constitution? Do you have to sign up for any other roles to vote no against the Na'i Aupuni Constitution?
Actually, the Constitution that was crafted left it open to be determined. I don't have a negative in front of me, but I thought it was going to be here. It was left very broad in the language as far as how a registration would take place, but it was very clear that all Hawaiians would be eligible to vote. It didn't specify any specific registration process, and that was something that many of us went in there to fight for, so that we could make it broader than the previous Connecticut Road Roll, because we understood that that was limited, and we heard many people say why that was problematic. So we wanted to open up other options for people to register. For example, one idea that came up, and nothing's been clear cut yet, nothing's been decided yet, was if you ever registered for any Hawaiian scholarship from elementary schools, my homeland, Koha, Aloha, whatever you have to do with Hawaiian ancestry, you can bring your documentation and go vote at a polling place. That was something that was being allocated for. Again, not decided. But that's the type of voices that was in that room. No, it's not, it's undecided.
It's undecided.
It's open. You may not have to, hopefully not, in my opinion.
So you guys don't know yet? Are you guys gonna come to that conclusion, or is it just, we don't know?
It's gonna, you know, hopefully be decided soon. You know, I will have to agree with Dr. Trask that I feel like the federal recognition process and this nation building process that's been established is stalled. Yeah, but it's separate from the nation building process of just our people coming together and discussing like this how we're going to move forward and how we can build on that constitution, or in my opinion, even the Kalahui constitution, which was incorporated.
The wind, Rod, the wind. I'll give you a chance to respond.
Okay, so I'll leave that.
By elected representatives of Hawaiian peoples. It was copyrighted, as well known, because our Kupuna advised us, someone is right here, black people only, that the time would come when there would be pro-federal Hawaiians who would try to take the Constitution and manipulate it into something else. You will never have the Kalahui Constitution. If you do an educational process, and bring designated representatives from the community, you will have a good constitution that will have many things that Kalahui has in it. But you cannot designate those from Oa, not the Aupuni, the Shah, and CNAJ. The lot themselves and the government come out with a decent constitution. That's as cool as Kalahui has pointed out. You guys put the constitution in, not about educating the children. You never think about that, yeah?
By the way, I'm Theo. You've always been a people for life. A few weeks ago, I planted plants at the potential farm. The system came in and removed all my fruiting plants. I stood there crying. The difference between all of you and my people, I give life. I give many life. I give improved life. The potatoes are still hanging in there, the sweet potatoes. I'm going back and planting them. Mark up more potatoes. It's that simple to me, Kanaka. Another thing that I want you to understand is the blessing of knowing who you are. And it's not to be having to design this BS. Plain and simply, we're a poor people. To me, Filippo Souza. I love Filippo, that name, Filippo Souza. It's a Portuguese that held in there all his 80 years here in Hawaii for our people, for his wife, for his children. I love them. He's a perfect example of what will be the new Hawaii. Beyond the home, but also inclusive of those that are hanging in there. Where I'm getting confused as to, is he not Kanaka? He is Kanaka Moloko. So I have resorted to knowing that people is a person that I look up to as much as he says white
Are you that one person that just one person? I'm that northern person. That's the difference. I am one. And I now know the people is deeply for known. And that's what we need to be settled. And those of you that are suffering with different cancers that the United States has bestowed on our people, we need a large community hospital to accommodate all of you. That's the problem. We need to be a homogeneous society. Once again, nothing wrong with being a homogeneous, especially when we are born long, direct from God. Simple. No question. More discussions. Ah, how many? And people, I honor you.
Aloha, my body. I like to pull some things into perspective. And one of the biggest problems we have that stems a lot of confusion is the terminologies, the definitions that the U.S. uses that we subscribe to, which we should. Number one is we made our self-determination while we were kingdom, and it was reaffirmed at the Hui petition. So that which they are asking is for domestic or internal self-recognition. So it's a different thing altogether. The same goes with indigenous. We are not indigenous. Kawikioli established us as aboriginal, which is Kalamaoka'aina. And we were recognized as an international country, independent and sovereign. So you cannot use their words because they forget to tell you what they're asking for. They're asking for domestic recognition. People use the words colonization. We are not colonized. We cannot be because we are recognized as an independent nation among the European nations. So you cannot use that word. There are many words that they throw out. You have to step out of that U.S. box and speak up as a Hawaiian Kingdom subject, which I knew as a child when I was cognizant about things going on from age 8. That's been over, what, 60 years, 70? Who knows? I'm not counting anymore. But the thing to remember is that you have to know who you are. You have to speak as an equal to the United States, not follow their manifest destiny doctrines, which they are imposing upon us. And so there's nothing wrong with those who want to be foreign Americans. But when you go into the federal recognition program, which we all know from the Apopka Bill, you cannot negotiate anything from the Hawaiian Kingdom. So you being Hawaiian Kingdom subjects, you must first renounce your citizenship to the Hawaiian Kingdom and formally naturalize to the United States to join that little tribe. And I think it should be mandated.
There's a question that came in from our hashtag AAA Forum 2016. religious, sexual, and cultural tolerance in this election. Do you feel comfortable committing our a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States? This is for Robin Dan. In the wake of white America's apparent repudiation of ethnic, religious, and sexual and cultural tolerance in this election, do you feel comfortable committing our Lahui to a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States?
Well, first of all, no one is committing our Lahui to anything. There are many initiatives, there are many different kingdom organizations, we were part of Lahui, there were many Amas. So that's first and foremost. But I think the heart of the person's question is with the recent election. My question back to you would be, with the recent election and the descriptions and the adjectives of what that election means to some folks in terms of using the term racist, et cetera, it was a tough election. But my question would be back to you, what does that mean? Acquiesce? Does that mean I should pull my youngest son out of school? Do I turn in my driver's license? Do I, you know, these kind of things. That's the kind of question that is. And we live in the real world. Tomorrow, many of us are going to go to work. We're going to get in a car and drive it. We're going to take our kids to school, et cetera. So the recent election doesn't may cause us to do anything different. That is to be in a mind frame that someone else decides what we are doing. So the Trump-Clinton election doesn't freak me out. It's not going to change where my son's going to go to school, where my grandson is going to go to school. It doesn't change how I get there. So I'm not acquiescing to anything because of that election or any other election. There have been 45 presidents in the United States, and it hasn't caused any of us, and certainly not our Lahui, to acquiesce to anything.
Do I have any other comments from the other side? Any comments? Another question?
Volunteer. Come on, everybody. Give everybody a round of applause. 100%.
athletes coming through. They come back in the road. So this also comes from our forum on our Twitter. Yeah? And this is for our better recognition panel here. Did you see any chance of securing federal recognition through the executive or legislative branch before January 20, 2017?
No.
No.
Okay, the other side?
No.
Any chance of them achieving federal recognition before January
20? Inauguration.
Hello, my name is Mario. I do want to recognize I'm a veteran, I'm a military veteran here. I'd like to recognize them, but I'm in the field with the, I work with the Homeless Council, and a lot of soldiers, and because of our Great Warrior tradition, the Native Hawaiians, we've often taken victims of loyalties. So I get posed this question a lot. How does federal recognition hinder independence? Because I know you said you're not American, but you don't really want to be American, right? But as soldiers, when the Americans are loyalties lie. There's a reform on one side. If you go to federal recognition, does that take us away from our values, our coolest values, and possible wars? You know, that fought alongside other Hawaiians, other Native Americans. Does that take away from that? If that is, then that's a troubling thing for a lot of us. Especially for us that are already dealing with PTSD. And that's really when I was in the National Guard, PTSD was a big thing. Nobody recognized it back then. I worked with a lot of people in Pennsylvania, or Pennsylvania veterans. And a lot of them had no place to go. And when I came home, they still had these problems here with our own Hawaiian veterans. So it's not unique to Native Hawaiians, but it is something that has to be addressed. So where does the loyalty come from, and how does it hinder independence in every way of federal recognition?
Any side want to answer that?
I think the question is, how does federal recognition hinder independence? So that would be a question for Aloha. That was the question at the end of explanation.
So basically, when you look at what is the number one thing that defines a people as a nation, and that is land. It's land. You know, if you have a nation that has no land, when we have given it to, that document says
federal, state lands are off the table.
We've never given them our land, and that's what would happen. I honor every single veteran. My father is a veteran. He fought on both sides of this war. He was a veteran for the United States, and he was a veteran for our Kalamaoka'aina.
And that does not invalidate the bravery either situation.
But if you take our land, that is the one thing.
This extinguishes title to our land. We have never given up. Right now, things are being held in the courts all over the place. We have that 20% going to Aloha. We have never, ever yielded that. And that is something that is hotly contested, and that's the reason why this got fast-tracked. There was federal recognition takes so long, 2014 to 2016.
You ask any
Native American who is currently going through the process, it has never happened so fast, and why is that? We need to ask ourselves why. And Standing Rock is a great example. Do they care about our indigenous people? And we know that they don't. So why would they do that for Hawaii? Because they love us so much? Because they've taken care of us so well? They want for a reason. And you disagree with my analysis, but you have to ask questions.
I know, but you're right.
You
He asked a question that hits home deeply. In Hawaiian men, Hawaiian women, you're gonna tell me that if I support one track and not as Hawaiian as you? That's the nature, that's the root of that question Mahalo's asking about. And then the basis of his question, the fact of his question is, how does federal recognition impact independence? It does not. You can do both, brother. Okay? So, and when you talk about fast tracking, no disrespect to Dr. Trask, this is your Ohana. This is a published, this was a published article in 1999 by Dr. Hamanikin Trask, co-founder of Aloha'i. The title of the article is Native Social Capital, The Case of Hawaiian Sovereignty in Aloha'i. The whole article discusses federal recognition and why Hawaiians should have federal recognition as a native tribe. And I know circumstances have
this
changed.
I understand
circumstances have changed, but the
point
is,
don't try to misinterpret my sister's publication,
okay.
Mr. Price.
The point is, this is not fast track. This
process
is started.
Mr. Price, you're lying.
The process is started.
Sister and I are not talking about your definition of federal recognition.
I understand that. But the process for federal recognition. The process for federal recognition was not what this is.
This is not federal recognition, Mr. Price, what you're pushing.
I'm not pushing anything. I'm talking about educational facts and then stop the mischaracterization so that people, our people, don't have to feel like they're less Hawaiian when they don't understand what's going on. Okay, that's what I'm talking about. Let's get to the facts. That's why mischaracterization is so deadly. It's deadly to our people. Okay? You cannot mischaracterize a political entity for the livelihood of our people. Aina, I agree with you folks. Aina, this part is
my
people.
Sister's work, Mr. Price.
Okay, I wasn't going to misquote, I was going to read a quote.
Sovereign.
Yeah.
Occupied. I know that there's some folks in the line who actually have, they're actually not interested in talking about federal recognition. They actually want to learn more about independence. Can we ask some of those folks to please move forward? We'd like to entertain some of those questions this time.
Let's just go.
I don't agree with that. I'm sorry. Let's just go with the next person.
Thank you.
I grew up Mauka on this building, and I cover facts. And the reason I cover facts is because I have been a plaintiff and civil rights attorney for 30 years. During several of those years, I was a judge. As such, when we read a document, which I have read, we look for two things. What is in the document and what is not in the document. Now, and so I'm one of those people that read the tens and tens of pages of the proposed rules as well as the established rules. What is not, well, this is an aside. We're having this forum, and I'm participating in this forum, but we are leaving aside a fundamental threshold question. Why does a nation, America, have the right to dictate to another nation, Hawaii, the way in which we are to form in order for the nation, the United States, to recognize the nation of Hawaii? In order to participate in this forum, we have to leave aside that threshold question. But I am not aware of anywhere factually in the history of the world or any nation has been able to dictate to another nation how that nation should be formed in order for the nation to recognize. More than your time. You do not respect the fundamental rules that we all agreed to. So let me finish my question that is going to be directed to both panels. What is not in the DOI rules? The DOI rules do not speak about nation building. They do not use the word nation anywhere. Why is that significant? They only speak about government to government. What they do say is that if we form a Hawaiian government, if any other entity does not follow, well, first of all, you have to follow the DOI rules in order to be recognized as the Hawaiian government. And if there any government comes after that, it will not be recognized. So my question to both panels is this. We speak a lot about how independence and these rules establishing a Hawaiian government can coexist. I would like to know from both panels, how is that possible? How are we, if we do agree to support the Aupuni Constitution, which is then going to formulate a Hawaiian government that can speak to the United States government, and then rebuild the nation, how is the independence of the nation supposed to be reconciled with this Hawaiian government? I have a question for this side and for that side.
Because there's many kingdom experts, advocates, whatever you like to call it, have stated. The kingdom was an internationally recognized government of multinational citizens. Both ethnic citizens.
What?
What is?
Stay with it, no.
So, I'm telling you, I'm saying.
We're discussing the DOI rules.
You just asked how two could coexist.
No, we're discussing, you're here advocating the Department of the Interior rules. Formation of a native Hawaiian government that will then be recognized by the United States. My question, you have to stay within that context because it's not.
The rule,
why are you here?
The federal rules are for domestic recognition.
My question is,
does it to be recognized?
Establish a Hawaiian government, how do you reconcile that with independence and the formation of a nation?
Because there's two separate sets of claims. It's two separate sets of claims. A native The recognition of indigenous peoples was established through the UN process, which didn't coexist until the 1940s. The kingdom was overthrown illegally in 1893. The kingdom's claims will not be impacted by the claims of the native people. The native nation is not claiming to be the kingdom of Hawaii. That's the key.
If the Hawaii nation forms a government, its own constitution, under the DOI rules, will the United States government recognize that nation with a constitution that is separate and apart from the Nowemapa? That's the question.
So are you asking if there's two separate documents and two separate constitutions, which ones do the United States talk to in international relationships? That's the question. Which one? If there's two constitutions, which right now we're looking at...
The United States has already said the Kingdom of Hawaii does not exist in numerous United States cases, so I don't think that they would... They're never going to exist to acknowledge the kingdom.
Why not?
Okay,
so
it's not the same. They already said
they have.
What I'm saying is, our claims for a kingdom, we're not going to knock on the United States door and get recognized as a kingdom first. We're going to have to go in the international arena, which was what I said earlier. The international arena is where the kingdom claims take place. Simultaneously, we can work with the United States as indigenous people. Not to give up any rights, but to assert more rights and gain more access to them.
I'm going to take a minute a little faster. I know everybody's getting really deep the line. I'm just going to stay for a minute. Let's talk story. Okay, so I'm just going to ask really respectfully, can Josh moderate for this, and then you can just tell 1 minute, and then everybody can agree to that? Can we agree to try and keep it short, and then not talk over? Please, is that okay? Because this is a conversation, right? Y'all want to talk to them? So let's give it a chance, okay?
Understanding is with time, yeah? With time. You're not going to be able to get to every single question. Just to manage those expectations, yeah? So out of respect for each other, yeah? If we could, and I'm a hollow type of problem tomorrow, but I need to continue to do this, but if we could ask a specific question so that the panel can answer the specific question, and then we can have a discussion on such specific question. Did you know?
No.
We all agree to that?
So I'm gonna answer the question that she asked for both sides, to ask how you can reconcile the Constitution. And I say it's impossible. You can't, because you have, it's not one building upon the other. The way that this Constitution is written, there's tons of representation of Kalapui, there is the 1864 Kingdom Constitution. Those create the processes of which you identify the leadership. And then they're going to take these programs and they're going to run them. That's what the domestic federal recognitions are talking about. They'll run these programs. Is that something? Factor is that you can't reconcile the two of them. What's going to happen if you create a civil war?
Okay. Much of that love. I'm checking too. Okay. Our question, when I ask some specific questions, our speaker is going to have 2 minutes. Okay? We're going to stop them. I'm just going to tap them on the shoulder, but we're going to stop them and just going to, yeah, we're going to move on. Okay? Okay? We're good? I really am mahalo to you guys. Okay? Let's go to the next question, please.
What Indian tribe in the United States of America that's acquired federal recognition ever successfully then secured independence for the United States of America? The answer is none. The question I have, so those that are talking about, if we do federal recognition first, they can do independence. We're precluded, not only because there's never been a precedent by any Indian tribe to ever successfully do that, but secondly, there's a federal statute which precludes us if we are recognized as a federal tribe. This federal statute precludes us from pursuing independence. So on two counts, what you have just stated tonight is completely untrue, because no precedent has been set by a single Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition. And secondly, federal statute, Title 12, does not allow us to move forward past the recognition if we want to secure independence. So on both counts, you're wrong. So let's get our facts straight.
Was there a question? Okay, well, I'm gonna respond to your answer. You're right. However, like I said, a Native nation is not going to, it's not able to make the claims of the kingdom. However, if our people begin to build, if we build a government and gain resources, yeah, and we start to build, we can get international recognition and eventually evolve into the kingdom. If that was ever to be a choice.
There's not a single sentence in the DOI rule which would allow you to develop our lands. Where?
What law are you doing?
Look on here. On 172 pages of the rule, where does it say anywhere that you can develop lands?
It's not part of the that's a great, to point that out. It's a good opportunity to educate once again on what the Department of Interior rules are about. The DOI rules are not a land claim settlement. We would not want lands to be in that process. The DOI rule isn't even on us. The earlier speaker, it was a mischaracterization. The Department of Interior rules are for them. So it sets up a process how they would, if a Native Hawaiian government comes forward to have a government-to-government relationship with them, the DOI would have to follow Part 50. Number two. There are over 566 Native American tribes. Free out of mind. They have been going to the UN long before we have, and are still going to the UN. So, and holding on to their federal recognized status. What federal recognition does in reality is it allows the Native people to take their assets and resources
and control them up under Native control, rather than a state government or even a federal government having all that control. So there are the Lakota, the Navajo, all the federally recognized Native governments are indeed at the United Nations and should be at the United Nations fighting that fight. The real question, sir, is name an Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition, and sister, I really appreciate it, recognizes and understands how the law process is for them. Name a Native government. These are smart people too. We're smart, they're smart, that have requested to be unrecognized. Not one. Not a one has said, I don't want my rights under the Indian Self-Determination Act.
Thank you.
Whatever efforts Aloha Āina Community Forum, whatever lot they made.
There's been nations that there's education, there's awakening, there's awareness. And those are the kind of things that will allow us to achieve what we're going after. But it's a process. It's a process. Now we've got to own up with it. Now we've got to understand that we're in a position where we are only getting stronger. We're only getting stronger. So it was, if that's the best they've got, we're getting beat. If this is the best America's got, we already got to beat because we're only getting stronger. Three generations ago, my kupuna signed the petition. Kahikina, Kahtuubila, Nabolua, Makahue, Kumuhone. They signed that petition. And generation by generation, we became a little bit less calm, a little bit less quiet. But the shift has already occurred, and it's turned. And I think that our generation, my generation, is in a better state than the generation before me because of the action, the struggles that they went through. And if I continue to struggle, my kid and my whole food and the generations after me, they'll be in a better position. But we got to struggle. We got to struggle.
Experiences from my family, many people close to me, they've struggled a lot. And I know you said that you acknowledge that there's been a struggle. I don't know how deep some people are willing to let the struggle go in order for they think the system is going to come so broken that people can suffer. I'm not sure to the extent people are willing to go, but I'm not willing to go to that extent. And I'm going to use education as one example with the educators over there. A practical solution, potential solution to a $1 billion budget under the DOP that does not adequately fund Hawaiian programs. And I'm not advocating here. I say, she asked for pathways, she asked for specific answers about independence. And I haven't heard anybody ask these questions from an international independence arena under federal recognition. You would have autonomy with an educational system to negotiate with the state and the feds to get resources to administer your programs autonomously. Outside of the umbrella of the DOE. I just think that's a practical answer, potential solution.
Okay. I am my father's daughter. My father's name is Kanaka O'Neal-Pio. My name is Willa Leonardo. I want to share with you what those of us grew up in Hawaii instead, and are now DCs, and what we're going to go through in the bottom left. I'm going to read from my poem what is being asked of us by Department of Hawaiian Homes. Public hearing set for December on DHHL's proposed administrative rule changes. State of Hawaii Department of Hawaiian Homeland. Notice of public hearings on proposed amendments to Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules. The Department of Hawaiian Homelands, DHHL, will hold statewide public hearings for Hawaii Administrative Rule amendments. The proposed amendments to the Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules, Department of Hawaiian Homelands, cover several topic areas, which include the use of DNA testing to help establish familiar relationships for the application and process and successorship designation, subsistence, agriculture lots, etc., etc. That is coming up on December 6th. I am to ask the question. The question is, on both panels, do you feel that a government agency should be making a rule as to who my mother slept with? That is the question. And that's how far they've lowered us. I find this government entity heinous and criminal to even make a rule as such.
It's been clear that the United States has only had their own personal agenda in mind. You know, they didn't take us over because they wanted to benefit us. They took us over because they wanted to benefit themselves. And every rule and every kala-kala that they printed has always been to benefit them and not to benefit us. You know, we could have tried to have a win-win, but there has never been an attempt for a win-win. There's been a lose and a win. And they're the ones who win. They're the ones who are acting like they're the boss of us. You know, like we said already, nobody gave them permission. My kupuna never gave them permission. I never gave them permission. My kids never gave them permission. So really, it's about us decolonizing our minds. We are not part of it. We don't want to be part of it because we are not former.
Question with whether a state agency should be deciding those things or telling us what to do. I agree with who the answer is no. And that is why self-governance at the international arena through independence or at the domestic level through a recognized Native Hawaiian government is so important, so that we are deciding these kinds of things ourselves. No, they should not, state agencies, the federal government should not be making decisions about DNA, blood, etc. Thank you.
Right now, it is 9:38. We're gonna change our rules just a little bit, if you guys will allow it. To speak, the questions, they're gonna have 30 seconds to just ask the questions. Yeah, and I should have did this a lot sooner. But please ask a specific question, then we can have a speaker's answer, and then we're just gonna try to ask one question, and then we'll go move on. And I come, mahalo all of you guys' efforts, so be patient.
My question is, where is the jurisdiction? We were invaded January 17, 1893. July 7, 1898, we became a territory by two pages. It was a joint resolution. Now, in U.S. constitutional law, a joint resolution has no boundaries outside the boundaries of the United States. So the question is, how does the federal recognition apply to the fact they have the state that doesn't have the islands or means of boundaries? Dr. Williams and Chang proved that after 20 years. I'm just saying, where is the jurisdiction for an outside entity known as the state of Hawaii under federal recognition? It's not an entity that has the jurisdiction under two pages of the joint resolution. There's no treaty. That's the problem. We need a treaty. There is no treaty.
Mahalo. Does that answer the question? The jurisdiction?
The Department of Interior rules, once again, I will repeat, is not the establishment of a government. It is not a land claim. It does not deal with jurisdiction. It is purely very limited scope. It is the regulatory regulations over the federal government on how it will respond and assess criteria when recognizing and deciding to have a government-to-government relationship with whichever Native Hawaiian government decides and wants to come forward and present itself. The federal regulations are there, they sit there, they may sit there and never be accessed. So they don't, the state of what is in relation to the Auntie's question, federal recognition or federal acknowledgement or government-to-government relationship, once acknowledged, state is automatic. They don't have a choice because they are part of the system. County governments will not have a choice because they are part of the state agencies. But the Department of Interior rules does not address land or jurisdiction, nor should it, because that is a question of the Native Hawaiian government itself.
No jurisdiction, and so basically it does say in the DOI rules that we yield to the plenary power. And so what we have on the international realm and also domestic within American law.
law is that there's no treaty of annexation and that there was no vote in Congress to make us a part of the United States. So we have a legal basis that we will deal through this process.
My question has to do with climate change. So we just elected a president who wants to dismantle America's commitments to address climate change. And so for me, that brings up another huge urgency to our ability in Hawaii to address climate change. Because scientists have said these islands are going to be impacted more than any other place on the planet. We are going to face that now, and I'm glad to hear you say, Robin, that you support independence eventually. But we haven't had any support in terms of dollars to help us do the work that we have to do to get there. I think we need to get there faster because recent scientists also said that by 2036 we will see sea level rise in these islands. So question is, will you support, and I ask Oha this question, will you support funding equal for independence to get that work done that was spent thus far on the Atapa bill and every other effort for federal recognition?
Okay.
Are you ready? I'll ask a question. You know, as well as I, as a participant in half the room supporting independence, and was very adamant about any movement going forward needing to be an open process that engages all voices. So, my personal question, I mean, my personal answer, based off of the answer and providing what is in the Constitution, is yes. Of course, we would support that.
No, I'm asking the question is equal funding for pursuing independence as a citizen?
All pathways, yes. Just as we discussed in the
Mahalo.
Mahalo. Mahalo.
Mahalo. Mahalo.
Mahalo.
In regards to climate change again, we know who's responsible for us. It's not the native people. In fact, it's the native people that scientists around the world agree will bring the answer to the problem. So again, we're going to that point of being part of the colonizing nation makes us part of the people who are destroying the land, versus if we were to do our own thing like our supporters, we would continue to model our island like they did for thousands of years.
I think the young lady brought up a good point about climate change. I just wanted to respond.
Sorry, you're very helpful. Sorry, move up to the next one. I'm sorry.
They wanted to make up less than 25% of the general population of Hawaii, yet over 50% of the children in Hawaii's foster care system are Native Hawaiian. Half of those children are faced with non-relatives. Parents struggle to comply with Western-based services, and many do not be invited to their children. How will your movement help to turn our children home to their families?
Who's that question for?
The Native American Indians raised this question only in the last 25 to 30 years. The Congress responded by passing the Indian Child Welfare Act, which gives to Indian children the right, when they are taken from a dysfunctional family, to be placed with a family that is Indian. At that time, we said, to ask for inclusion, we could not get it. Regularly, Hawaiian children are pulled out of their Hawaiian families. They're raised with Oriental families and always. We do not have the right to place our children. But we tried to get in the law. It's like that brother that was a veteran talking about loyalty. I took 25 years of my life to fight for the right of Hawaiian vets and Indian vets to be able to have a benefit when they came out to build a home. Because the veteran benefit was given to all the veterans, but never to an Indian or a Hawaiian. Because they lived on trust lands that was communal lands for the people. The same is the case with the United States. There is no right to protect your children other than the Congress saying it. And when the Congress passed the Indian Child Welfare Act, they left out all the children that wasn't recognized. They left out the children of the Pueblos. It wasn't just the Hawaiian children, but to this day, we don't have that right. And that was another big deficiency that they left out of the Aupuni Constitution. Because we wouldn't have it under their federal recognition.
But actually, I think that the answer to your question is that federal recognition allows Native American Indian children to be placed in American Indian homes. So yes, federal recognition does support that you're asking
but
about.
But it's not in our country.
It doesn't have to be in the Constitution. We're not recognized one, and it doesn't have to be in the Constitution. It was left wide enough that it would be included in a statutory body.
It's not in the Constitution.
The practice among Hawaiians is that we ma'ama'a'o. So in our Hawaiian focused charter schools that have not been supported by the state or the federal government, we make sure all of our teachers are registered foster parents so that they can take the kiki home when they need to be ma'ama'a'o.
Rule, not because I'm happy of what was in it, but because it brought Manapui together, period. We need to have more discussions like this, and I'm Manamani folks, and I'm Manamani, I understand that we need to go to a struggle, a Jewish struggle, and I'm getting to my question, but I'm worried about time. I have dedicated my life, my kupuna have dedicated my life to protect our natural cultural resources. I live it every day, and I see our native wildlife dying every day, along with all of our resources. I see it dying, just like you guys do. Time is of the essence. Now I want to know, my question is, I want to go down the road right here. What are you folks individually willing to do to answer the tough questions if that is what you really want for independence? What are you going to do to work across the table instead of saying, this is my constitution, this is your constitution. I'm going to give you the Kalamaoka'aina constitution, you have your constitution over here. I want to know, how are we going to work together forward?
Ever.
who specializes in human rights and self-determination, who I think is qualified to say what she said. Her name is Maimana, I never saw her, she's been an ally for many years. She said that during the time of the DOI hearings when they came around to the islands, she said that the essence of self-determination, and I'm going to play the self-determination game right now, of course I'm for independence, but she said the essence of self-determination, nothing could be more self-determining than showing up in person and testifying as a real live human being, testifying your vote, yay or nay. So we were, she said, that is the most powerful expression of self-determination in person. And so we were dismayed to learn that the DOI rules passed, because most of us, many of us, witnessed all the hearings on each item. And some of us, including myself, actually counted the numbers. And the numbers averaged around 150, 155 testifiers. And we counted those numbers, and just about consistent with every hearing on every item, about 95% of the testifiers said, "Apole to the rules. No, we don't want them." So how did they pass is my question. And my understanding is that pro-rule, the people who were in support of the rule passage, organized this postcard campaign where you just check off that you support it and mail in the postcard. And so, were the postcards counted more than the real life? How did they get passed? Is my question to both sides. How do we explain that? Is that really self-determination? Maham.
The opinion is that the essence of self-determination is that the most powerful expression is important is in person. It's not the, maybe in person, it's not the only way to express support or opposition, but I think that you must understand that the DOI's job was to evaluate the content of the answers. So did you answer the questions being posed? Their question was, we are looking at promulgating a rule. What do you think about this? What do you think about this? Many of the oral testimonies didn't address those questions. It just said, go home. We don't want you here. So you didn't give them something substantial to say. You weren't answering the questions. You were just saying, go home. We don't want your rule. Okay, they noted that. But there was a lot of substantial testimony provided answering those questions that were posed. And I think that there were card campaigns on both sides. Yes, we saw cards for opposition and we saw cards for, and that's part of what Davis was talking about earlier, engaging. That is our civic duty. We should definitely be engaged. Whether you check a box, get out and write your testimony, do your oral testimony, it all counts. But it comes down to the content. Did you answer the questions that were posed by the DOI?
And the question that was posed was a flawed question in the first place, because they are not to repeat the boss of us. So to count as the boss and act as the boss, if you're not the boss, then all I can tell you is for whom you are not the boss. When our Kukuna signed the Pule petition, they have a keynote, they read their first, they put it in front of other people as witnesses, and many of them had ramifications because they were pro-Hawaii, they were pro the Queen, and many of them lost their jobs, especially those that are working for the state government. So our Kukuna stood up and had the balls to stand up as Hawaiians and Pule, and I think all of us Hawaiians should do the same.
Okay, and go home. No, we don't want it. It sounds pretty substantial to me.
Yes, sir. four more question answers. Now, Mahalo, we're going to close this up for these last four questions. Mahalo, all of you guys for your guys' patience.
I do want to make sure, though, that you know that you can go online. There were 5,124 comments that are public, so I encourage you to go online and read some of them out.
I'm aware
of it. Okay.
Mahalo, Mahalo.
You should have.
Definitely. You did.
I guess my question is one that relates to the DOI ruling. I actually read 172 pages. And I want to ask you all, whoever read that thing, did any of you feel like throwing up? For sick to your stomach? Because I have never read anything in my life that made me sick to my stomach. When I read that thing, it is filled with generalizations, purposeful avoidance of facts. Never once mentioned that Hawaii in 1843 was established a sovereign nation. Why would he say, who wrote the DOI ruling? Who authored that thing?
DOI.
DOI. Yeah, and another thing is, if you read it, you will see things. Like, how they say, oh, but nobody answered that question. They avoid things in there that are important facts of history. Why do we conjure up this something that would be read by people who are not educated about our history? And they'll say, oh, so that's how they're taking care of the native Hawaiians. Oh, okay, that's what happened. Oh, yeah, so Kamehameha, in there they say, so King Kamehameha was able to unify the Hawaiian Islands under one kingdom. And then there was a few other monarchs after that were able to keep it going. That's the kind of thing that's said. Who wrote this thing? Who wrote the DOI ruling? Because they tried to put it forth as if it's a sovereignty, but it is not. It's filled with fallacies.
The question was, who wrote the DOI ruling?
So,
who wrote it?
The federal rulemaking is a long-standing process. Is that a new process?
Author,
can I please answer? So there are federal regulations done for housing, there's federal regulations done all across the federal government. I want to make sure I'm correct, because maybe it's partly why there's this contention. The regulations are not on us. The regulations are their regulations on them. And typically, the authors of federal rules depend on what the subject matter is. In this case, the subject matter is the trust relationship and the federal staff or the legal standing status of Native peoples. And so it involved not only the Department of Interior, it also involved the Department of Justice and attorneys and long-standing folks that have experience. But again, what's important to say, actually, the historical writing in those rules are pretty darn good. And second, again, I say, those rules are not regulations on me as a Hawaiian. They are regulations written by the federal government for the federal government.
I just want to leave everybody with this. Please allow me to see this. I'm going to summarize the DOI ruling for you, real quick.
We got three more questions. Disrespect the person behind you. You're jacking that mic.
In lies this thing. The United States admits to hoping to steal the bar in the country.
Please, my next question. We have three more
questions. Accepting the stolen bar. Now they're telling us they're going to allow the right components to see the back from the
folks saying, and I've heard this from other folks too, that
those two paths of independence and federal recognition are not mutually exclusive, right? And that they could work together. So my question is, why then, given that, you know, we've definitely heard the concerns of the people over and over again that federal recognition could be used by the United States to claim that the claims of the kingdom are settled. And so if there is a concern that those claims could be, you know, that the kingdom could be said by the United States, right, regardless of what any of us do, it could be said that by the United States that, oh, don't worry about it, this is settled, which, by the way, was written in the report that was commissioned by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs last year, James Anaya and Robert Williams, on page 24 to 25 of their report. They did address that, and they basically said that, well, yes, that is a problem. You know, the U.S. certainly could make that claim. However, the only thing that we would need to do would be... the only thing that we would need to do would be to stand up and say that, you know, we deny that. It hasn't been settled. So my question is, why has no one on the federal recognition side stood up visibly and said, we refuse to put our kingdom in this? You know, we want to be very clear that this does not settle anything. I haven't seen that from anyone. I haven't seen the recognition, and so I'm wondering why hasn't there been a recognition of what everyone else is saying and what their concerns are?
First, I want to touch on something I said when I first spoke. I'm not up here, much as you guys may not believe it, because it's how we really divide it. I'm not an advocate for federal recognition, because I don't know what federal recognition is going to look like, because we haven't stood a government, we haven't held elections, we haven't begun to negotiate with anybody realistically as a native governor. At that time is when I will decide when I'm a supporter of federal recognition. It is a tool and a pathway that I'm willing to consider. Clarification. Now, to answer your question, it's in the first, I believe, the preamble of the Constitution. Everybody that supported the Constitution on a process moving forward, it left independence on the table. It said that we can still pursue independence. It's specific, and that was a very hard fought battle. That was a very hard fought battle by many in the AHA to include that language in there. It is in there. So there's different opinions in Oahu, but they worked it out. Wow. We have said it. I have said it.
Yes.
And also the DOI rules, the Part 50 rules, already answered the question. There is no necessity under federal recognition to stand up. It cannot apply, does not apply to our international rights, our rights that remain within the kingdom. The Part 50 rules, in fact, kingdom. Individuals ask specific questions of the DOI in that ruling process, and the DOI answered them on that point to make sure that they are separate and they do not intertwine. But this is also why I want to say to the other day, I support both. I support any funding for either to educate our people on either front, that we should continue to join to the UN, just like other federal recognized Native nations are funding themselves to go to the UN. It is not or, it is and.
You know, there's only one UN expert in this program, and it's not me, Robin. You cannot rectify or justify these things. You can take the word independence and stick it in the paper, but it does not provide rights to people. It does not return their land or give them restitution for the overthrow. instead of saying, if you want independence or if you believe in human rights, go to the United Nations. Wrong. We bring the human rights home. We stay home. You go.
That if the Aupuni voted for this, we can all sign a document saying that they will absolutely refuse any type of government that in any way yields the independent nature of the Hawaiian kingdom, that we will absolutely refuse any negotiation. And maybe we can start talking about this and say that yes, you can have two different pathways. So if you guys, are you guys willing to all agree on that? That every single 81 of you, that you will absolutely refuse any type of situation that will anyway.
I would sign up for something like that. Absolutely. I have to fight for the pursuit of independence to be included.
That's an easy
yes.
That's
a compromise. That's how the world works. I don't agree with you.
That's an easy yes. That's
okay, let's
happen.
Work on that offline. Okay.
So this question was already asked, but there was not really a clear answer given, and it was in which case has federal recognition ever resulted in any of the Native American tribes achieving sovereignty or trading with other nations, sovereignty in a real sense, independence. Thanks.
I think we did answer that. I think we did.
You said
it better back.
Never.
But I clarify that the Native peoples is different than the claims of the kingdom.
Yes.
Okay.
I think that's a critical point. And also, there have never been an unrecognized Native group, and there are about 60 that are applying for recognition now. They have also not been recognized, nor have they achieved anything from the International Native Indigenous Body. Okay?
Well,
that's
all the
stories I have. That's the stories I
We're at overtime. It's 10 o'clock. I'm going to put my hat over here because we need some donations. We're going to continue this discussion, but somebody's got to pay the custodian. Aloha Āina will. So if those who want to help contribute to Aloha Āina so we can continue this discussion, please join right here.
How much are we making?
Let's keep going with our questions.
Aloha! My question. Are you pointing out how it
matters? Well, she got all the money.
Yeah, well,
I'm sorry.
Oh,
sorry for the shake. I'm putting some money in.
Yeah.
Okay. People generous. You put money in there.
Mahalo, everyone. Mahalo.
I want to show how much money.
This one won't last in
time
right
here. That's not $18. We're on the end of the table. They might help it.
Okay, they're not far. Here
we
go.
There's the money. That's pretty good.
So my question is, hello, my name is Tyler. Can we as a people and both panels, can we make a commitment to start the process of reestablishing either a government or a kingdom? Minus the oppressor, because the way I feel, you cannot steal from my house, you cannot take from my queen, and you do what you did to my queen, and think you're sitting at the table with me, and you will tell me how we're going to start a government. We backwards. So all of it, we need to take that. We need to put a DOI. Wait. Because we need to establish ourselves first and foremost, minus the oppressor. So can we make a commitment as a people, as Hawaiians, to start our government?
Part of the reason why I engage, and I'm sorry because I've got the ear wall up here a couple of times myself, and I apologize. But part of the reason why I engage in this process is because
You gotta understand that everybody at these tables has worked, I'll excuse myself because I want to let you know, their whole life for our Aupuni. Regardless if you're in agreement with what they do, they work their whole life. We gotta talk to each other and respect. Kalamai for me losing my cool a couple of times. But just wanna reiterate that. We all here for the same reason. We all here because we know our people gotta move up. Okay? So we all need to commit to each other first. That's it.
Mahalo, mahalo, right on, man. Mahalo. Hello, leaders. Early in the on field, I'm going to call my son, you my ears are from Makuo Kiawe. We're all here discussing the Constitution. My question to you guys is, who voted the participants in to write the Constitution?
Nobody.
When you write a Constitution, you have to have delegates. Who's the delegates? It was participants. I never voted for not one representative that could represent and speak for me. Not one person could speak for me because we had no delegates to vote for.
There's a justice in that.
How can you say you're writing a constitution without delegates representing the people? Question, simple. How can you be appointed? How can you be appointed participants?
I understand that the process was broken. I know.
It was what?
But it's broken.
You're talking about my family's at the beginning of time. It was broken?
The process of many Aupuni.
Okay.
Broken. We good, okay? The process of many Aupuni was broken. That's why I, personally, and I don't speak for anybody else, I did not believe that the best way to approach that process was to disengage. That's me. And I don't judge anybody else who took their own pathway to disengage, protest, participate. I say for me, I wanted to get in there to see what work was being done and what was going to come out. Now, I know that I didn't want to represent anybody but my ohana. That's it. Okay? And that's what I went in there and spoke on behalf of. So now, and fought to ensure that nobody in there watching, to make sure that nobody in there was going to take that product and try to do anything that represented our people without taking it out to the people first. And I can assure you that that constitution will not have any impact on anyone unless it's voted on by our Wahoo or our potential Wahoo.
Okay, now, question is,
but why should it even be voted on when it was developed by a flawed process? I mean, I don't think it's, you know, as a teacher, I wouldn't allow you to take something that was HEPA and then tell you vote on it when you already know it was HEPA and you don't admit that the process is flawed. So that's not a constitution. You shouldn't call it a constitution because it was not created the way constitutions are created, which is two delegates. And certainly, some of the people, and I have to say my own students included, certainly would have never been delegates if there was a vote.
And that's also one of the legitimate reasons to not engage, but that is yet an individual choice. I don't speak for you, and you don't speak for me.
We use $32 million of all money. All the trust money was allocated for you guys to do it.
So every Native Hawaiian is Native, and we all have our individual choices. And so I absolutely respect Ku's manawa on that, that she does not like the process, and she made a decision not to engage. I was not in the aha, but I made a choice for my ohana. I am going to engage.
People were paid to do that. They were receiving money from my trust money.
Mahalo, Mrs. Danner. Mahalo.
Thank you.
Mahalo. Can we get the next question? This is from John Sorum. He said, do you see any chance of securing federal recognition through executive or legislative grants before January 20th?
The answer was a definitive no.
Yeah, they said no.
The answer was no.
Mahalo.
Next.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's unnecessary. By January, June, March,
okay.
September, it's unnecessary to achieve by any deadline.
My question has to deal with the recognition process here. I've heard Bob and you've reiterated that recognition can still proceed forward. One, you can go for international claims, and you can go for domestic claims. in the United States. I limited my scope of question to stage 47 of the DUI rule. It explicitly states that this recognition that will be provided to the Native Hawaiian people is not the same that their ancestors enjoyed via the Kingdom of Hawaii, which is a nation-to-nation status. Now, the other questions that were asked was, has any federally recognized tribe or non-native tribe, have they ever achieved nation status? Because I think what people are trying to understand here is, if we somehow go down this route, what would be the process in which, if we take a DUI ruling and its status, will be that? But I also ask a further external to that question, is that, what if both happens? And I'm just going to pick up your mind here. What if every law and the state joint government goes out and they come back, you know, in a couple of weeks, and they've got 5-6 countries full-blown recognition of the reinstatement of the kingdom? And what happens if your folks come out and you guys entertain a DOI ruling and it's signed by the what happens then? You're going to have two processes standing over here.
That would be so awesome.
That would be civil war.
No, it wouldn't.
No, because the question that would be asked, and that's where I think you're the more qualified to ask this, is the question that the world is going to be asking is, who has the higher authority here? The injured party, or the part of the people that resided from that injured party seeking to create something new?
David, you answered that part, but I do want to acknowledge your first question. Exactly. The DOI rules on May 42 say this process, everything about it, has nothing to do, has no impact on the international arena. You made our point. The DOI said itself that this regular Part 50 has no impact whatsoever on international
arena. No, my point was that it's about recognition. They're saying that the recognition, if you will, is not talking about things, it's talking about the status of political stance. You won't have kingdom status.
Correct.
Right. That's my point.
That's what it's saying. It is a dream.
But
hold on.
So, over the point, like, Davis,
you can do both. If that choice happens, we're going to be the luckiest people on earth. I don't know. We're going to announce that happens.
I think you have to just basically look at the land, okay? Where does the land go? Who decides where the land goes? And they're going to make this decision. They're already negotiating, and that's the whole point of it, that this group of people are going to negotiate the land away. And you can't have two different authorities determining where the land goes. You can't.
Okay, Robert,
I always I don't have to interrupt other people. So, that there is the land issue. Who gets to control that? And the question that really comes is, not just land, who gets to control these programs? And that's really the question immediately, is they're making a bid to control these programs, coming in as schools, is one. If they're protecting the right versus Kaipana, the definition of who gets protected via service, you're talking about Aloha, you're talking about Oha, you're talking about Queen of the Okalani Children's Center, you're talking about Kamehameha School. They are going to be determining who gets control over those. And I have to ask, and I have to ask you guys, did you guys ask permission from all those people that you're going to negotiate on behalf of everybody in the one entity?
Who appoints Kamehameha School trustees right now? Exactly. Not Hawaiians.
Not Hawaiians.
Mahalo. Next question, sir.
Aloha. If in that 173 document, it did state in the article that Hawaiian sovereignty has never been abrogated or relinquished.
Yep.
That's a fact. Neither has Hawaii been compensated, nor did they get consent. We're talking about theft. In anybody in other language, you need to talk about damage, not about continuing to be a ward or a part of the franchise that's signed on for the debt. Because as long as you're attached to the debt, you're going to be just flip-flopping our guns, that we're not really sovereign until we issue our own currency again. We'll be sovereign. We can't be using the Federal Reserve Note exclusively This is why the Indians don't have any sovereignty. They gave it up when they gave up their wampum. So where is Hawaii's wampum? Where is the instrument that makes it indeed a sovereign? You have relations with Japan. Japan was the first nation recognized by Hawaii. That's an international agreement and recognition. There's Hawaii groups working on relations with other nations. That's sovereignty. To beg the United States or to accept any thing that they got to say, you capitulate to what they say. So you have the status to say, recognize and execute.
My name is Jeremy Walker, I just want to put out some information. There has always been a constitution in the Kingdom of Hawaii. There has always been a seat in the Senate in Washington, D.C. for the Kingdom of Hawaii, which has been empty for many of years. Thank you. So, from what I heard from the Frederick side is that you guys are willing to work side by side with the independents, right? So, was there any money allocated to the independent side, to the money that you guys have received for their process as well?
But my question is,
the funding that you got to create your constitution, was any of those monies allocated to independence groups to support their independence as well?
No, but it was not my understanding that. And that decision, regarding your statement earlier about the $33 million, and just so you know, so I am an aide to Trustee Daniel, who is not only aide to the Office of Foreign Affairs Trustees. The only trustee who voted consistently, though, who voted against Kamehameha and Kalei Aupuni. So I'm not here representing any of his beliefs or anybody else from our Office of Foreign Affairs or the practitioners of Kalei Aupuni here at the individual capacity. Those decisions were made before I got there. OHA adopted a policy in 2001, Board of Trustees, to support federal recognition. Now, to clarify, again, if I don't agree with how the money was spent to lobby and promote federal recognition, I cannot disagree. But understand that, you know, to villain, in my opinion, the people who have made those decisions were villainized. And you gotta understand the context of the history that Rice v. Kaikana, which came down in 2000, threatened every single piece of Hawaiian programming that exists today. And it was done there was a mad rush to push the Akapa bill and do everything they could to protect Native Hawaiian programming because everybody thought they were all going to fall quickly as a result of lawsuits. And there were lawsuits against every single trust, Hawaiian homelands, commandment schools, OHA. And as you know, commandment schools, 20,000 people marched to try to overturn a Supreme Court decision in 2005. And the only reason why I never got to the Supreme Court was because commandment schools had to settle, cost them $X million. So just take into context, before people make judgment, take into context why decisions were made. Yeah, there's nobody out there trying to sell, that I know of, trying to sell our people under the bus and sell nobody out. Everything has been done for a reason. There's less power.
So just to address as far as the money goes, so yes, we did not receive a single dime. And that's because funding and grants are based on giving reward to that which you want to achieve. And so, essentially, what they want to achieve is that we have a very compelling case because the United Nations will not support a nation to dismantle like the United States. They won't support it. So they require us to give up our sovereignty. So that's what they're paying for, the $33 million is to pay for giving up our sovereignty because we have, under American law, their own law, that we are an independent nation. So the argument is we will not challenge the boundaries of the United States because we have never been a part of the United States.
And
last question.
I'd like to the one rather, I'd like to direct this question to Brahma. Now that we have heard just recently tonight that Aupuni conference was broken, I would like to know if that's the case and that the constitution that was created by non-delegates, non-elected delegates, and I understand by international law that in order to conduct or create a constitution, you have to be an elected delegate for the government. So my question to Robin, if that is so, why did you get $7 million from the Office of Hawaiian Affairs to ratify that constitution?
Okay, so first of all, there hasn't been a ratification of everything in the constitution. I don't know what $7 million you're talking about.
It's in the Hawaii Free Press.
Oh, that's a reputable.
OHA has not provided any money. I can speak on this from my capacity over at OHA. There has been no money provided for any ratification process.
Has not been.
So you're calling this article a liar? Yes.
Absolutely.
100%.
Hawaii Free Press is not, I wouldn't, you know, bank my kids on that.
Okay. Andrew Walton.
So you say this is false.
And I would also encourage every independent advocate here to advocate to the Board of Trustees and Office of Foreign Affairs to change that policy that I mentioned in 2001 to include supporting international recognition.
And to stop reading Hawaii Free Press.
So I don't believe
$3 million is more than we have to pay. $33 million already.
Everyone, I really appreciate and all of you for your patience. We're going to, if you will allow also us to circle up, let us pull in, and the kukaakalao, say our closing pull in. Let us leave all this energy here so that when we go home, we can leave all of this here and have our safe travels, right?
Mahalo, Joshua Noga.
Thank you.
Tonight it went long, we've been live, we're live 3 hours and 40 minutes. Mahalo to Aloha Āina. Big mahalo to Josh Nonga. Big mahalo to the speakers, absolutely. This is really good. Next time you should try and be here. If you're from outer islands, maybe this will come to you. So thank you for joining us. Thank you. I'm going to mount this up on YouTube eventually. Hey, there's the man. Pono ke aloha. Right. I'm going to cut away now. Thank you so much.